Welcome to Blink 155, the only Blink 182 podcast where Josiah has spent a day teasing me with some sort of secret or anecdote the whole time before we started recording. You were like, I got to tell you something, but I can't. Do I need to wait until after we say the song title, or are you ready to go right now?
And also, just I have so many funny things that have happened to me since last week.
You have so many funny things, Josiah. I think that's why people like you so much.
So many funny things happen to me all the time.
just the hapless protagonist of existence.
Yeah, and so I just, before I get started, I want to tell you, none of these, I haven't thought of a pun for the title. I don't care about this song. I have a feeling it's going to be a good episode because of some of the things I've written down, but I don't. This song doesn't deserve a pun. But anyways,
wow.
Yeah, these two things are kind of tied together, and the first one is the more recent one that happened. We were just finishing dinner and watching Schitt's Creek, and then I came to the computer to tell you it's time to do the pod, and then I just looked at Twitter and I saw that Flea from Red Hot Chili Peppers is talking to me.
What?
Right now? Yeah, it's because this guy Tony Hartman. Shout out to Tony Hartman. He was on, I think, the marketing Scloosy or something. I don't remember. some of them are a real blur.
Yeah,
to me.
That's fair.
But he was on a Scloosy one time. He's a friend of the show, and he loves. You either love or hate when Drew and I go into a days long Twitter argument.
I want to make my stance on this very clear. I absolutely love it, but I'd be curious to know is it a 50-50 thing, or like what's the ratio really like?
I think of your friend group, it's 1 in 10 people like it.
Okay,
to start with,
and in your group of friends.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, thankfully, most people who are my friends aren't seeing all my tweets all the time, and that's probably why they're still my friends. But, so Drew rapping for Safety, of course, from the Loudness Wars episode. Keep an eye out for Loudness Wars Part 3 at some point, too. He's also been on our Twitch channel a bunch lately.
And also, he's of course, the host of his own show, Just Drew's Show.
Just Drew's Show, yeah. One of the all-time great podcasts, I think. But yeah, we like to just sort of go back and forth with these endless arguments and dunks and japes on Twitter. And Tony knows this, so he tagged us. So Flea, today, I guess we're giving away, we are doing this on April Fool's Day. Flea wrote, "Remember when rock music was wild?" And Tony very rightly saw that this would be a place to get Drew and I involved. So we did get involved. Tony said, "Do you guys remember?" Tagging us in Flea's "Remember when rock music was wild?" And then Drew said, rock and roll used to be what it's all about, and now you can barely find one. And then I replied and said, "Rock and roll is live and kicking. You old timers just need to know where to look." And then from there, actually, Drew and I had a little back and forth as well. But Flea decided to reply to me and say, "Tell me." So literally, not only is it like the worst to have a raucous conversation on Twitter, but also to like, in general, I think to field recommendations on Twitter is a fucking nightmare. Like, I thought about the other day, just like tweeting, "Does anyone have any good Netflix recommendations?" And then just like logging out of my account for the next 2 days.
Forever.
Like that's like a Eric Alper style viral bait sort of thing to do. Just like recommend me some. So now anyways.
Your Netflix docuseries is the name of your best friend's pet growing up. Yeah. Crossed with the last record you bought in an actual record store.
Wow. I'm trying to think, but I already sort of blacked out. Trying to imagine either of those things. Probably Tiger King would be the name of my thing.
Wow.
Just a little topical joke here.
That's some great topical humor here.
So anyways, Flea asking me to tell him about what I think is the best rock and roll is already, I had to just admit to him right away that he called my bluff. Like, I don't know how to explain this to Flea, who seems like a really chill guy. But then on top of that, now I'm tagged in everyone on Earth, like, sharing their friend's rock band or recommending King Gizzard and the Wizard Lizard Wizard guys or whatever. Like, it's like my mentions are exploding as I speak with people recommending rock music.
Oh, wow. I'm going to be honest, man. There have been times you know, I think we've talked about this on the pod, but like it really, I think, started around like obviously the sort of night that Trump was elected. And then like every time some new coronavirus thing happens where I'm like, occasionally it does feel like a dream. Like it's like, it's just like, it's the world has just gotten too fucked too quickly, too close to home. But then like, I'm like, no, well, that's obviously not true. But then you tell me that you are in an unstoppable Twitter thread of people recommending rock music to flee. And I think maybe I'm in your dream. Like maybe, you know, at some point in the pod, like our brains just slipped together and I'm experiencing all of your sort of, your personal hells at once.
Right. Well,
I can't believe you didn't recommend some rock music to flee though. Like I feel like admitting to flee that he called your bluff is honest, but a cop out. I'm disappointed in you.
Should I tell him what should I recommend? Junior Battles?
You should say rock and roll is podcasts now and tell them to go on Blink-155.
Yeah, like that was like every time my guy died did that tweet the other day about like how podcasts are the new punk or something. Are
like the troops and the punks together.
Actually, that's our Twitch stream. But neither here nor there. What I would... Oh, this is a good segue. Okay, ready? What I would do... leads me to the other thing I was going to tell you.
Wait, what you would do to what? Sorry. It wasn't that great a segue.
Response, I'm sorry. Yeah, I got too excited. Yeah. In response to Flea asking for recommendations of rock music, what I normally would do would be to recommend my own band, Prenup.
Oh, yeah.
But this is the other thing I've been wanting to tell you kind of for the last couple days because it's so funny. So I'm going to close Twitter so I can focus for a second.
Thanks, man. I feel respected.
On my own speaking. Yeah, focus on my own speaking. And I've already opened the tab again because I want to find something while I talk. So a couple weeks ago, I don't know if people have been reading the news, but this COVID thing still going on. COVID still happening. But because of that, you know, all the artists have been fucked. All the precious ticket scalpers. That's another Twitter bit that I do is like praxis for ticket scalpers is my new favorite.
They're workers. Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, so
who side are you on? Live Nation's Ticketmasters or the yes. working person? Come
exactly.
on.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So all the shows were canceled. Everyone's obviously been kind of freaking out because they're not getting that sweet revenue or those sweet, sweet drink tickets that they've come to depend on. And so Bandcamp, as everyone knows,
stop coming to people for enjoying a beer every now and again, huh?
Well, that was more a joke about how, like, you don't get paid to play a show.
Yeah.
You just two drink tickets each.
We had one show canceled and we absolutely saved money. We are one of those bands, so.
So the Bandcamp, to, like, make up for this, obviously a couple weeks ago did that thing where they gave away all of the revenue from Bandcamp. Do people know what I'm talking about? Because I feel like
everyone knows. Bandcamp waived their fees for a day so that artists could like aggressively promote, you know, their music and take 100% of the proceeds.
Exactly. And so, my friend Mila, New Yorker Mila, she's a great friend of the pod as well. She wanted to post the Prenup album for her. She was going to post about it and be like, oh, everyone buy things on Bandcamp. Here's something that I love. And she messaged me and was like, hey, I'm trying to post the Prenup album, but I can't find your page. I can only find like the label that put it out. But like, what happened to the Prenup page? And I'm like, oh, that's weird. So I logged in and it just didn't like the Prenup Bandcamp is completely gone.
What?
It's like straight up gone. 100%.
Did Flea take it and now he's taunting you?
It's even better than that. So it's taking.
Wait, I'm sorry. It's better than Flea deliberately deleting the Prenup Bandcamp page and then waiting until you tweeted at him to taunt you about it?
I think
that
it's
would
like,
be pretty fucking good, man.
That would be good, but I feel like that would be amazing, but it's beyond the realm of possibility. But okay, what I'm about to tell you.
I just want you to admit that. That's all.
What I'm about to tell you is enough within the realm of possibility, but also so ridiculous and amazing and it could only ever happen to me. I'm sure Bandcamp has been completely fucked from like how busy they've been with all this stuff, right? Like the last thing they need is some guy emailing them. But
also saying that something can only happen to you really makes you sound like you're on a reality show. It's like the only time I think anyone really is like, could only happen to me, you know, two girls, you know, in the house at the same time. What? Okay. And there's a fire? Oh, no.
Look, the reality I watch is Terrace House, and it's not like that one bit. But, I'm getting ahead of myself. By the time I'm done this story, I think you'll agree that it could only happen to me. So, poor overloaded Bandcamp workers have probably dealt with all kinds of things because they had so much traffic. The site crashed like 20 times that day. But I did contact them. I was like, hey, did you delete our... for some reason, I thought maybe there was something copyrighted in the art or something, and they just deleted. I was just super confused. Mm-hmm. And I use a burner email for the Bandcamp, so I thought maybe I just missed something. So I emailed them, and they're like, oh, no. They told me a date. They're like, on February 20th, someone with your email address logged in and deleted the entire page. What? And the account, and we can't restore it.
What?
And so then Sarah and I were like... kind of freaking out, like, is this to do with the lost UPS computer? Did somebody like break in? But then why would they just do that only and not like steal our money?
Well, but yeah, so are you panicking? So do you hear this and then do you immediately go and like check like your credit card or whatever?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. We're like kind of panicking, checking everything out. And then I'm like, honestly, like I spent the whole day feeling like a little bit uneasy and on edge and kind of stressed
I'd
out.
I'd be panicked for sure.
And also, like, not that it really matters, but it was just kind of nice to be able to have a, like, the music's still online everywhere, but it was nice to sort of have access to one place to share it all or kind of have it be our own. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of, like, bummed, kind of stressed out. And then I remembered something. I remembered that this whole time that I've been shit-talking people on Twitter... I used a burner account for our Bandcamp, and also I'm pretty sure I used the password because I was like, I'm never going to remember my band's Bandcamp. And the prenup.bandcamp.com URL was in that was my link in bio on Twitter. And so I thought, oh, they've told me the exact time that
oh my God.
This was deleted. And so I searched through my tweets and I found the evening of February 20th, 2020, this was when I was deeply obsessed with the Justin Bieber song Yummy Yummy. And I had copied and pasted what they call a copy pasta of Girl, You Got That Yummy Yummy with like 100 terrible emojis. Is,
like, truly deranged looking.
It is. And so... no one will know that. No one really saw this happen, but the night that I posted this, Robin Hatch will know because she got involved, but no one else did. But the night that I posted this, somebody found this tweet and I had actually copied and pasted it from them just by searching it. And then they started like accusing me of stealing their tweet. And then I was like, oh, you stole it from me probably. Like I was just doing the kind of thing I do with Drew.
I've seen you. Yeah, this is a good recurring bit that you two do.
Yeah, I usually say that it's parallel thought eventually with a stolen tweet.
Yeah.
But this, somehow we accidentally stumbled onto these like Manchester Football Club lads from the UK who were like a troll farm. And we both started getting like tons of mentions, tons of people going crazy. It like went all night. And the timing is so perfect, and I was going to confront this person now, but they've since been banned from Twitter. But all I'm saying is, literally, I stole a Justin Bieber Yummy Yummy copy pasta full of emojis, and then somebody got mad and deleted my band's Bandcamp.
Holy shit, dude, that's the fucking... Can I be real with you?
Yeah.
That could only happen to you.
Right. Ladies and gentlemen, fighting the gravity.
You know, the thing about you on Twitter, Josiah, is you did not log on to make friends.
That's true. I didn't. I don't know why I did log on, but.
What are the other, you know, and, you know, it's too bad that you got thrown under the bus, for, you know, by Robin Hatch for stealing that tweet.
She told me that around the same time people had been trying to log into her, one of her old email addresses. So I think they really were angry that we, that I stole the,
that you stole. Okay. And I just want to make this 100% clear. It's girl, you got that. Yeah. It's the lyrics to Yummy. And then like 200 emojis. Like it is.
I was just too lazy to type them out.
So you, but how did you, what, how did you find the tweet to copy all those emojis?
I just thought to search girl, you got that yummy yummy on Twitter.
You goddamn, you thought to do that?
Yeah. You know what? Another one I've been thinking of and doing quite regularly lately, but I haven't done a post yet because they're all too sad, is if you search I be on that suit and tie shit, you can find some real losers at weddings. It's really sad.
That's, you don't need to like just shame people for being on their suit and tie. That's not, that's punching down, Josiah. That's below you.
I'm sorry. Well, I don't know. I it was genuinely a wake up call. And this flea one is maybe in a more positive way too, but like, I gotta be a little bit more careful because people can read these tweets.
Cause you're so used to everything going fucking great where it's like, oh damn, I dunked on, you know, Dan Reynolds. Hold up. Dan Reynolds and I are best friends. I think you're so used to just like charming people after you've kind of pissed them off, and maybe you're flying too close to the sun. You're becoming like Twitter Icarus, you know?
It's true. Yeah, I don't know. I'm kind of, I don't even know what to do now. So I guess, I mean, obviously what I'm going to do is keep posting exactly the same as before.
That's because you're a troop. Just like Keith Buckley said.
Maybe I'll try to stop making my password password for certain things. I just never would have occurred to me that someone would get mad and then delete my entire Bandcamp.
I mean, that just like absolutely fucking rules. When you think about like that person getting so worked up that they're like, what can I, oh, I'm going to, like it's kind of deranged and I respect it immensely.
It's so good. Okay, well, I already said the song title, so...
Yeah, no, we're in the episode now. How do you feel? I mean, I know, but why don't you say it for the people, what your early opinion on the Blink-182 song Fighting the Gravity is, Josiah?
I'm kind of, like, scared now, because I've always known in my heart that this was my most hated Blink-182 song, and then when I just listened to it right now, it was still awful, and I still hated it. But, like, maybe I've changed a little bit. I don't know if it's worse than Hungover You.
Yeah, you sort of had primed me, and we've talked about this being the worst song before. Before we even recorded, you were like, we should just do it. It's the worst song. We should got to get it out of the way. And then when it started, I was like, I don't think this is the worst song. I don't think it's a good song. But as with every shitty song on Neighborhoods, it's better than anything they've done since. Maybe except for San Diego and Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And Bored to Death.
And blame on My You.
Yeah. But like with notable exceptions, with like an EP's worth of exceptions across two 45 track albums. This is the worst song that they ever recorded with Tom. Maybe.
I still think it's pretty fucking bad, though. Like, I mean, it
sucks. It's just nothing.
Compared to a lot of the other songs that you even mentioned, it doesn't even feel like a song. What this song reminds me of is the exact feeling of, like, and I love the band Fucked Up, but it reminds me of listening, being on, like, minute 65 of a 90-minute Fucked Up album where it's mostly really good songs, but then there's, like, some kind of weird, shitty bridge thing that probably ties the narrative together somehow or something, but you're just, like, you start getting a bit of a stomach ache or, like, you start feeling dizzy from how long you've been listening to this kind of extremely compressed punk music.
And yeah, like, no, the part of the album where, like, everyone else has lost the fight and it's just Mike doing Mike stuff.
Yeah, there's like a flute solo.
Yeah, and you're like, you know, it's all about balance in this band, you know?
Yeah, it reminds me exactly of that. Or like the year of, you know how they still do the year of the thing all the time?
Like year of the Tom.
Yeah, this is, and yeah, it's true. This feels like a, I guess the problem is it feels like a Tom song, but it's like Mark trying to write a Tom song. And he's just like Mark's been blessed with the ability to just like write the same bullshit song within the same standard major chords, major scale chords that he always writes every time. And he's been blessed with this kind of like idiot brain where he just thinks that he's doing something new each time. So for him to try to make like an experimental song is just kind of like, it goes against God's law, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think like when it came on, I was like surprised with how much I liked how it sounded. And I forgot like you know, this record, for all of the sort of chaos of how it was assembled, I think still kind of sounds cool sometimes. You know, and there's like a weird desperation to the way, you know, in retrospect, you look back and knowing how it was assembled, that like they're just sort of trying to hold this fucking thing together. And so I think it's like, even when just sort of like the full kind of like the drums and like the bass and everything kind of kicked in on my headphones, I felt like I reacted physically to it. Like, as I was just like, I'm just going to put the song on and hate it for, you know, 4 minutes or whatever. And I was like, wait, like sort of my head rose up from my desk where it was sort of rested on my hands as I wept softly. I was like, is this fucking rock? And then I was like, wait, maybe this song rocks. And then like, when it was over, I had like forgotten I was listening to it.
Well, yeah, like I think it's just, it really is just the production, like also not sounding like a Michael Bay movie that makes mm-hmm. you think it's good. But like there's no melody and everything, nothing's really in key with itself. And it's the same feeling that I'm describing is when you're like, maybe like you have an acquaintance who is feeling out if they want to start a band with you, and then you go to their jam space and like spend 3 hours trying to jam and it's just like not working, but it's too, no one is like sort of has the social grace to leave without being rude, so you're just still there. Like, it just feels like you're still somewhere that you shouldn't be for too right. long.
Yeah, it's the sort of like best before date is long past. No, everyone's getting kind of tired. Your yeah. best days are behind you. And this is when, and then Tom just leaves the band.
Maybe he heard this and was like, fuck this.
I mean, it feels like a Tom song. Like, I feel like it's interesting that you said that, because like that to me, like I thought this was a Tom song. And I know we've said it's about Mark and doing acid and whatever, and we've talked about this plenty of times on the pod. In my head, I was still about to listen to a Tom song. And I think it's because the title sounds like an Angels and Airwaves song.
Yeah, and I think all of Neighborhoods feels like Tom songs in a way.
Deep. That's good, man. That's some fresh new insight. Episode
155.
Yeah, this is it. The last episode. RIP yeah. the pod, died of coronavirus.
I was meaning to listen to it more times today, but then I just kind of put it off, and I guess I'm thankful that I didn't listen to it more times because I might have ended up liking it, but
you should send it to Flea.
Should I right now?
Yeah. Okay. Be like, here's one. This is fun. I love controlling your game.
Flea. Can we put featuring Flea technically?
If he responds, if he's like, you know, not totally my thing, it's featuring Flea immediately.
But you know, someone's going to pop in here and be like, oh, okay, yeah, you're doing this song this week, but that's okay.
That's fine. Like, listen, people are looking for kind of glimmers of hope wherever they can get them right now. And I think, you know, letting someone who happens to look at a thread between you and Flea know what song we're doing, that's just nice. It's just true. Like a very sweet thing to do for our pals.
Yeah. I don't know. This song is just like, even have you looked at the lyrics? They're just really, really bad.
No. So, okay. What's the deal with this? So this is about Mark. This is about an acid trip.
I think so. There's a few quotes from Mark about it. Let's start with this one. There's a track by track commentary about the album, apparently. So you got the link?
Yeah, I got the Genius link.
No, I mean, there's an audio
track.
Oh,
right. Yeah. This is amazing.
Ah, Fighting the Gravity. What can I say about Fighting the Gravity? Ah. It is a very strange song. It's one of my favorites on the album because it's so strange. It started off when I ran a drum machine through my bass amp, turned up all the way, and the kick drum shook the building so much that the light fixture in the control room was shaking. And we actually mic'd that up, and it's the rattling kick that you hear at the very beginning of the song. So listen for that.
See, wow. So there is like a beefy kick there that literally made me sit up.
True.
So that's cool. But it's like one of those things where anytime you do any recording like that, where you're like, we recorded the drums like, you know, outside at 2 a.m. And it's like, they just sound like fucking drums. Once everything gets compressed and put on Apple Music and like spit out as an AAC file, and you listen to it on like the earbuds that you got for free with your phone. Like, you're not hearing the building rattle.
Yeah. But like, it would be shocking to meet someone who like records, even just self records music, who doesn't have some trick where they're like, yeah, we wet a tea towel and then
sidechain it.
Yeah. And then we do that in our butt crack with it. And then we put it over the snare drum, and then we leave it in the shed for 3 months, and then we come back and record, and you get that, it's kind of a Beatles tone on the snare that you get from that.
The only people who are allowed to do that shit are Foley artists. Like, you know, every time you watch some like yeah. behind the scenes ass, like where you're like, here's how we made footsteps, and you're like, what the fuck? They like shot a man on the street and sawed off his legs. Like, that's these dudes go to fucking extremes for their craft.
Do I guess I'm just kind of a truther in a way that I don't really believe Foley artists exist anymore. Like, they must have all the sounds they need by now, don't they?
No, there's still like a Fred Willard type guy, just, you know, I think you should leave style, just yeah. ring, darka, darka, you know, it's still happening. I don't know, man. Hold on. Is Foley still a thing?
You're so informal with Google.
Oh, apparently they're only, I've recently discovered that, because my Google style used to be like fully active, ongoing, you know, where I'm like trying to, whereas now I'm just like, Google is built for like me, the dumbest person on earth, to be able to be like, do Foley still? And they're like, sometimes Foley. And I'm like, thank you, Google. And so it turns out Foley is very expensive and is only used on like huge budget films.
Well, because I feel like you'd have to, like, write some kind of new idea to come up with a new sound. Like, what's the movie going to be that would have a sound that you've never heard before?
Hmm. I mean, this is what's so exciting about the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So many new spaces to explore. And what do those sounds sound like? I don't know.
Well, I think they sound a little something like.
And then fighting the gravity starts. It's great.
Yeah, every Marvel sound is just that sound. That's all it is. Okay, so this didn't help us at all. That we don't care about how you put the kick pedal in a microwave or whatever. Like, that's boring.
No, that was cool because it made me feel vindicated for what will be my only insight as to a thing that I remember about this song.
Well,
because then it turns into Love is Dangerous in my mind.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think maybe it does. This was also something that whenever we talk about it, people get mad because we're so incorrect. But there is something about this song being on the deluxe edition that's like the deluxe tracks are sequenced in the middle of the regular album. And then it's all fucked up. Who cares? Like, if you want to learn about that, go listen to a Blink-182 podcast. This is a Foley podcast exclusively. So,
oh man, I remember seeing one about how they like did all the waves crashing in the Indiana Jones. There's like lion roars and stuff in that. It's fucking sick.
So the truth is that the song Mark has said is, I can't find the exact quote right now. Maybe I'll find it in a second. Here's the quote that is from a Reddit AMA, and you can tell it's from a Reddit AMA because of the last sentence, which we'll get to in a second. But he says, "Fighting the gravity is about a night a long time ago where someone put something in my drink. I had no idea what was happening and thought I was dying. The whole world felt malicious and angry. I could barely move from the immensity of the Earth's pull. I got into my girlfriend's car and said, please just drive." And then Mark closes this up by saying, "No me gusta." So he's like doing like rage comics, I guess.
Wow. Is Mark a Redditor?
He must be. Like, I'm surprised. I'm actually surprised more celebrities don't have those troll rage comic faces on their t-shirts. Like, there's that classic Adam Sandler one with the, I think, "You Mad" troll face shirt. But you know that Mark definitely fucking loved rage comics. What a nerd.
For sure. I also like that he has, this comment has +5 as well. Now I'm just looking at the Sandler.
That's just the +5 is just a remnant from me pasting it from Genius.
No, I get it. The the Sandler fit is so good.
He's so cool. Yeah.
Except so how lame is it to get a shirt that has that on it? See, that you can't do that.
I wouldn't mind a shirt that's like Mark Hoppus with turned into the "No Me Gusta" face.
I mean, yeah, I would definitely buy that. Man, Sandler wears this shirt like all the time, eh?
Oh, yeah.
This was not a one-time shirt. This is at least four different instances of this shirt on Sandler.
So when you try to, I'm just trying to find confirmation that it was actually acid, but it's just showing me people on Reddit saying that this song is an eargasm for them and that these are some of Mark's best lyrics. So the opening, the intro of the song is, this makes no sense, this makes no sense, this makes no sense, this makes no, 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 no. And then that's repeated.
I think you should read the whole thing for effect. 5 times. No, go.
This makes no sense. This makes no sense. This makes no, 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 no. This makes no sense. You can keep vamping while I do it. This makes no sense.
No, I think we gotta like live in this.
This makes no sense. This makes no, 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 no. This makes no sense. This makes no sense. This makes no sense. This makes no, 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 no. This makes no sense. This makes no sense. This makes no sense. This makes no, 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 no. Maybe the song is quite good, actually.
I feel like you should like go and like check in all the dark corners of your house now, because that started to feel like a real like incantation sort of energy.
There's going to be a rage comic come to life in my house.
Flea is just in your corner and you're like, what?
I don't think Flea is in my corner. That's the problem.
Has he responded yet? You'll let me know.
I don't know. I'm getting so excited. I don't know. We know that it's about Mark being dosed, which also makes this more of a fucked up song than we might even realize. But like, I guess the first thing I want to ask you is, have you ever done psychedelics?
Yes. Yeah. Mushrooms. Have you?
No, I haven't. I've only smoked weed like twice. We've talked about this before. Right. That's it. That's the extent of it.
I mean, yeah, again, I think it's sort of safe to assume that anything either one of us told the other is like not information that either one of us has properly processed retained.
I still think we need to preface it all with that.
But I even, you know, this week, you know, because I'm, you know, trying to be conscious of...
You did mushrooms this week?
I did mushrooms this week because I was so stoked. No, but I had like a... this is all feeling very sort of kismet-y. You know, I'm just wanted to sort of do a look at sort of all of our spending. Look, it's coronavirus time. It's like, you know, where can we kind of tighten our belt and stuff? And I'm paying like a little bit extra for like Google Drive storage, right? So I'm like, you know, there's probably a lot of crap in my Google Drive folder. So I'm going to go in and like, just like, if I have them backed up somewhere else, just delete the big files that are in here. And I forgot that I had backed up like one of my old phones, you know, from maybe like 6-7 years ago. And all the photos were there and I was like, oh shit. And I like opened up the folder and the first photo I clicked on was me and some other friends, who had done mushrooms. We were like up, you know, north, outside of somebody's parents' house, like on a country road at dawn. And it's like this insanely blurry photo from like this old HTC that I had. You can't see shit. And I was like, I remember taking that and being like, this is how I feel. Not like blurry, but like fucking alive, man. And I like shared it with them. We were all like, yo, this photo is sick. And so like literally I was, and that was the first time I ever did mushrooms, and it was like a high school version of just like high school movie of how fucking great it can be to be on drugs.
Right. Okay.
Have you ever been curious? Like, I mean, obviously, you know, you weren't I feel like there are a lot of people that like don't fuck with weed or anything like that, but like everyone, someone ends up curious and they only do acid. But you were not that guy.
Yeah, I've heard of people like that. No, my dad was. I have talked about this before as well. But my dad was like really into psychedelics in high school, and I think I even told a story on the pod once before. But my grandpa accidentally took acid because he was like investigating something that my dad's friend had. Like my dad's friend was visiting from out of town.
I'm not gonna lie, I don't remember that.
Yeah, I think I tried to gloss over it because I don't know, like, I feel like I need to...
It's familial information, I get that.
Full permission, yeah. But, like, he basically was like, what's this in this sketchy kid's bag? And he, like, dipped his finger in it and then put it on his tongue. So he, like, straight up did acid. So that reminds me of this song a lot, of, like, a Baptist minister accidentally getting dosed. And then I think he was mostly just like hiding from the mailman, like around the corner, like peering over. But yeah, like my dad kind of like already did all the drugs. So I didn't really ever feel like I needed to, because he just kind of was like he sometimes in conversation when I was growing up, he would just all of a sudden be like, and get like a flashback chill or something from.
Is that real though?
I mean, for him it is. I feel like
he was just doing that for you, just like
it's scary.
Yeah, a bit of a flashback. You know, you can't be a pilot.
Yeah, I don't know. Like maybe I could see. Like I feel like mushrooms is kind of like the worst way to do psychedelics.
It is. I could never do like a chemical psychedelics. I think I'd be too scared and have a horrible time. But mushrooms, like, I mean, I've done them maybe 3 or 4 times and like just love them. Just think it's just a real special time. But I've been, you know, very lucky and you know, always had a nice time, and I know other people have not. And so obviously not for everyone, not advocating drug use, but fuck, mushrooms rock, man. Oh, I want to do mushrooms. I have some mushrooms left over from last Pooza Fest.
Oh my God. You took them at Pooza?
No, well, we were trying to buy, I think, weed, and the guy only had mushrooms, and we were like, all right. So we just bought mushrooms and took enough not to like be sort of, you know, the night is magical, but you know, still, you know,
You're microdosing.
Yeah, we were microdosing.
At the pop punk festival.
Exactly, right? Classic.
Now that
classic
seems
fun.
Like it could be the name of a Junior Battles EP.
Microdosing at the pop punk festival. That is really good. So I do have some. Maybe I'm gonna fuck. This would be a great thing to do during quarantine. It's just
you should have done them for this episode.
I should have done
acid for the episode.
The best thing about it is like Ashley will have absolutely no interest in it, and so I will just be really high on mushrooms, like unable to leave my house. So that will be good for both of us, I'm sure.
So okay, you have some experience with psychedelics. I have none. To me, it just seems like everything would be blurry a little bit. But like I've said before as well, I kind of think that smoking weed is just the same as having a nice hot bath. So I don't really get the difference. I
mean, that's good. And it's not, I mean, it's like any of those, I think, kinds of drugs, is that it's not like drinking where anything is blurry. Like when the photo night that I'm describing, this sort of like high school movie, finding yourself, you know, on drugs night. I spent, I want to say at least an hour. I would say 2 hours, but I'd be worried that's hyperbole, staring at a tree like that was across from the house we were staying in, because it was just like the most beautiful tree I'd ever seen. And I could see the tree. It's not that the tree was blurry, Josiah. It's that the tree had never been clearer to me.
It was too clear.
Damn. It was intensely. Yeah, I didn't want all of that clarity.
The amazing thing is, though, honestly, like outside of just what my dad has said to me in general, people talking about doing drugs does not make me want to do drugs
at
all.
Oh, it's horrible. Talking about doing drugs, and that's why, like, even you, when you were like, you know, I was like, a minute, because I, you know, it's an exciting memory, and I love talking about myself. So of course I know I'm going to end up saying it, but I'm like, oh, fuck, I'm going to end up being a person. Talking about being high on mushrooms, like, who gives a fucking shit? Either you've been high on mushrooms, you're like, it's tight, or you hated it, or you've never done it, and you're like, shut the fuck up. Like, you can't, just don't. It's like drinking, though. Like, it's all bad to talk about.
I kind of feel like with the pod, it's like the days leading up to the pod, it's not that I'm preparing, but my mind will, like, think of anecdotes or stories or embarrassing things, and then it's not like I'm deciding that I'm going to say them on the pod. It's like, oh, now that that's in my subconscious, I'm definitely going to say it out loud into the microphone. Like, there's just no stopping it, really.
That's part of your preparation strategy, whereas I'm just like, I'll show up. Josiah will tell me what to do, you know, tell me where to stand.
No, but do you know what I mean? Like, if you, it's like an invasive thought. Like, if it's in your mind, you can't not say it into the microphone for all these people to listen to it. You have to say it for some reason.
Well, look, there's so many other nooks and crannies in that mushroom story. If you want to, I'll do a exclusive where I just talk about the first time I did mushrooms. You know, you can pay me $5 for it.
Well, we can talk about let's see if your experience doing mushrooms. I guess the problem is that Mark was accidentally dosed, and so that's maybe the issue here, is why he had such a bad time.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, I know people who liked doing mushrooms a few times and then had a horrible experience. But it's like anything. It's you know, anything that fucks up your brain, you know, isn't guaranteed to be a good time. So especially if you're not anticipating it, I can imagine that being absolutely fucking horrible.
Well, let's look at the lyrics and see if they're relatable to you. So verse one, the air is too thick to breathe. So just drive, just drive, just drive. These eyes are too sick to see, to leave me behind, behind, behind. Something's swimming in my blood. Something's rotting in my brain. I'm smothered from the flood. I can't recognize your face. I need to leave, so just drive. Okay, honestly, these are better than new Blink lyrics.
Yeah, that's the thing, bad. Right? I'll be honest, though, the behind part just reminded me of what is like one of the all-time horrible or legitimately great Eminem lyrics, which is in the song Numb by Brianna, where he boasts, I'm the butt police and I'm looking at your rear. So you're just going like behind.
I was like, the classier version of that.
Fucking Slim Shady.
Yeah, maybe these aren't even worth reading. They're not even that embarrassing. I'm so disappointed.
Yeah, I mean,
can't believe this. That's because I should never have admitted that this was the worst Blink song. But I think it's still... I think ultimately, like, in my life, I've always learned that my first instinct was right. Like, I'll hate a band and then everyone will love them for a little while. And then they'll be like, oh, wait, what were we doing? This was fucking embarrassing all along. I'll be like, I need to listen to my gut, my flora speaking to me about this. About what's bad. So I still think this probably is the worst Blink song. It's just I'm in the thick of it right now.
Well, I don't know. Like here, this is verse two, so I think it's worth mentioning this. Is I'm plastered, drywall. Look me in the eyeball. Do I look high? No. I love the way you lie, girl. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Come here, dear. I'm trying to get close to you. I'm motioning you to pull over, boo. I'm the siren that you hear here. I'm the butt police, and I'm looking at your rear. But odds are I'm going to end up in the back of the squad car. By the end of tonight, I'm a rock star. So, like, that's a bit of a – like, he's sort of done the behind part, but then he pulls in this rear thing, and all of a sudden, like, he's clearly experiencing something of a break because he now thinks he's the police of the butt. So that's –
I honestly don't know. I switched tabs and I couldn't tell if you were doing the Eminem or the Blink 182. Because okay. Like talking about dive bars is a very Blink thing to do.
That's true. Like, listen, if you forget, like, you know, I'm motioning you to pull over, boo is like probably not something that Blink would sing, but like
I feel like they almost could, like on a new one they could say boo. I feel like there's no reason why they haven't done a song called like Bay Watch, but BAE. <it's>
like, but like straight up though, like I'm trying to get closer to you, I'm motioning you to pull over, boo, I'm the siren that you hear here, I'm the butt police and I'm looking at your rear, like could be with some tweaks like a Matt Skiba verse too.
Exactly. Absolutely.
I am the siren that you hear here. You know, it's
yeah. There's what's with all this repeating lines too. And okay, like I don't remember how the verses go, but that first verse was long as hell, and then the second verse is just tonight is too much for me to get through. Tomorrow's just a darkened hall to an empty room when I'm far away from you. What?
See, and this is always the thing that, and this is why I'm way too afraid to do sort of serious psychedelics, is that
you're going to write a song this bad.
I'll write this song. I'm going to write Fighting the Gravity 2, doing mushrooms at the pop punk festival or whatever. But like when, like the worst nights that you've had drinking, like are mercifully hazy, right? Whereas like when you're having a bad time and you're high, like you're present for it, which is so much scarier. Like you never get scared when you're drunk, right? Like you actually get the opposite of scared, and that's why you often find yourself like accidentally dying.
Right.
And yeah, like, I guess that's so true, this probably. Notion, the whole way this is being described, I'm like, oh yeah, this is like what I'm afraid will happen if I do too many mushrooms or if I tried acid or whatever. Do you have any curiosity though about that? Like, do you like?
I genuinely have none.
Really? No. I wish I wasn't so afraid of acid. I would love to do acid, but I never will.
Just do it. Well, I'll slip it in your drink at the next live pod.
Imagine like as the sort of presentation or, you know, whatever we want to call it. Presentation feels very formal, but it's a presentation. It's it's academic. And then like I'm slowly like, what the fuck is Turbo House is starting to, you know, melt around me. Everyone's turning into the lizard people from the lounge in Las Vegas.
The most relatable thing for me is when I was having too much magnesium and it was fucking me up, making me feel sad. That's probably the closest I can relate to getting accidentally dosed with acid.
I mean, that sucks. And I guess recently when I had all that prednisone for my hearing and I was like, just could not tell if I was actually sad or if it was the drugs, and then I was up till 4 a.m. watching Spider-Man movies. Just like crying.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, ultimately, I think the saddest part is it's kind of interesting that this happened to Mark and they had this experience and wanted to turn it into a song. But I think it's just what really gets me is the "this makes no sense" part that I'll read again if you want, but I don't know if I need to. But
I'm worried that if you do it a second time, some sort of spirit will haunt both of us.
It's true. But yeah, like I just think writing that is like the sign that you're all of a sudden in a local band, I feel like. This is like a local band's psych rock song.
I have this like, I've got the virus, sorry.
Oh, shit.
No, it's wet. It's fine.
Not funny.
No, I know. Sorry.
It's funny.
Okay, funny. Good. One year going to Edgefest, which, of course, The Edge was the coolest radio station in all of Canada when I was younger. And they did this big, for a while, it was a touring festival, like back when people still staged touring festivals. So Edgefest was like absolutely the shit, where it was like the manifestation of the, you know, Big Shiny Tunes compilations that Mark Tio has written about. Because they would have like Creed or whoever like the biggest America band was at that time, but like the headliner ripple of them would be the Tea Party. And I remember right before the Tea Party in their, you know, set right before Creed played Fire in the Head, which is a great Tea Party jam. Jeff Martin, who for anyone not from Canada, like wants so bad to look like Jim Morrison. But
I feel like this sounds like a Tea Party song.
It, yeah, maybe that's it. So, like, he introduces Fire in the Head by going, "You ever have that one acid trip that goes just right? Well, this song's about that." And then they proceeded to play this, like, you know, honestly fucking sick song, Tea Party Rocks Ass.
Oh, they're awful. Terrible band.
I like the Tea Party way more than I like the Doors.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I
mean, the Bizarre, like, Fire in the Head, Temptation, Transmission, of course, the title track from the album that Temptation is on. The Messenger.
You also know so much about Canadian alternative rock.
Like, I don't
more
understand.
More than you even let on.
I don't understand.
Like, I feel
why
like you're constantly waiting for excuses to, like, drop tidbits about a Matthew Goodband enhanced CD content that you have or something.
I don't think Matthew Goodband ever had any enhanced CDs. I would love to talk about I'm Other or Scenery and Fish enhanced CD, though, which kind of had like a little mini fishing game on it. I don't think I've ever loved anything the way that I loved those bands at that time. And it's not even that I loved like every Tea Party song. I didn't. Like, Tea Party albums are fucking mostly terrible. But there's, you know, that sort of tragic nostalgic thing about like it's also just the way you felt at that time.
That's true. But
it
I
made
also
an impression.
The Tea Party and this song make me think of how, like, I think I'm very narrow-minded musically when it comes to like rock music, because there is pretty much only one kind of rock music I want to hear. Like, I don't want to hear these kind of weird out there chord progressions that don't work and don't make any sense and have like E minors popping in out of the blue all the time. Like, it just doesn't, I don't want to hear that. I just want to hear like some play off of the pop song structure, but in a rock context. That's all I want.
Well, you think the Tea Party is like too experimental of a band for you to get into?
Yeah, like it just sounds fucking gross to me.
They're just like pop songs with like too many tablas. They were like, this is going to make people think we're cultured. Tablas on everything.
Something about the, it's not just that. It's like something about the chord progressions too that just kind of grossed me out. And it all just feels very like, I feel like I'm like in Jesse Pinkman's house, meth house when I'm listening to this music. It just like grosses me out.
If you were to put like a sick beat under the Tea Party, 100%. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. But I guess I just was hoping that it would be fun to talk about my most hated Blink song, but it's just kind of disappointing, ultimately.
Wow. So, I'm sorry to... I feel like I haven't given you enough. Like, you sound really
no,
pumped
out.
No,
that's not you. And also, the great thing is there's tons of notes, but I got to show you something that just... something. This is just only for us. This is only for the...
a little just for the just for the chat?
Just for the boys only. Yeah, something else. Just, this is a good night for things to be happening.
Whatever you're about to say, just
computer.
Happened.
Yeah, look at this. That's
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I don't know about that either. Might have to make some calls. Maybe it's because there's been too much Drew content lately. Someone just edited their pledge. significantly lower.
Wow, significantly. Now, I know for a fact, one time this person did tell me what that meant. I don't remember. But I will say this. Originally, this was positioned as them supporting two listeners in a household. And now this barely supports one. So I trust that they will not share the sclusies anymore.
Well, we need to check because we need to crack down on that. One device only. Per
yeah, we're adding DRM technology to the sclusies. Listen, every penny counts during this crisis. Specifically for me essential. And Josiah, who have jobs.
This is completely we are absolutely essential.
Capable of doing from home. We are so fortunate. And if you steal from us, we will come for you.
I will literally kill you in front of your family. No, I won't. That's a joke. But, oh, I'm pasting it in the wrong window. We have a new method. So, I don't know. I feel like we don't really talk about neighborhoods very often.
It feels like it's been a really long time.
Yeah, so let's see what these is lads this you have and me? To say. It's me. Yeah, it's us. This is.
I forgot that we had this channel.
Oh, I know what's going on. I was like, why can't I hear the audio? It's because I'm only wearing one pair of headphones.
Oh,
not two.
You fucking
it's
idiot.
The new method.
You got a two headphone in. This used to be just like a stream only treat. By the way, we should probably mention that there is a stream happening again tomorrow.
Yeah, there is.
This is every Saturday. Every Saturday for the rest of your fucking lives.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, could you imagine if people started going outside again after this? Not safe. No matter what they tell you, don't do it.
No. Right before we started the pod, Ashton and I ordered bandanas to be able to wear for, like, the Mad Max future.
Oh, cool.
I'm super stoked.
Good idea.
Yeah. Supporting a local, like, you know, from Town Motos, a cool shop around the corner from us that we will never fucking go to again.
I was kind of thinking that I could do that with the few cum rags I have left, but my head is way too big for that to go around my head.
You should absolutely go to the grocery store with a thing that says Dude Ranch and like has a cum splash on it. I'll be honest, man. I think if anyone could make that, like, because they're sort of I'm trying to just conjure in my mind. I don't want to say paisley, but they're, you know, it's like a light.
Yeah, it's a nice print. It's a lovely print.
Yeah, and like I think if anyone could truly rock that as their facial gear during this crisis, it could be you.
I don't think we've really talked about this very much on the pod, but like I have a fucking enormous head. Like my head is so big, and I think it's because I was a cesarean section when I was born, so I wasn't crushed by my mom's vagina when I was coming out.
Is that what is supposed to happen?
That's just what I've always imagined because my head is like fucking mammoth. And so there's the Dude Ranch cum rag would never go around my monstrous skull, unfortunately. Otherwise, I probably would.
Do you have to buy
like
what size hats? Do you ever buy like New Era hats? Like, do you know what size hat you are?
I literally always like try on hats. And Sarah's always like, that is way too fucking small. You look ridiculous. So, no, there's very few hats that fit on my head.
Just picture you with all these little hats sort of sitting half down on your cute big head.
I got a Deadstock Green Day Dookie hat that is a snapback. And the snapback thing is broken on it from my head.
Oh, no.
From me wearing it.
So you had to like tie it using like elastic bands or whatever?
Like, I taped it like a nerd's glasses. In the middle, taped it, but yeah, no, I have a huge head, so unfortunately that won't work. And I'm not talking about my ego. I mean, my physical head is very large in addition to my ego.
Credit to you for not being like, I'm not talking about my dick head, because that's like, that's my head is huge. I'm like, yeah.
That'd be cool to brag about having just a giant helmet.
Like the rest of it is like kind of normal or like below average sized, but your belly is about, just fucking massive.
I feel like we've never talked about if we're circumcised or not on the pod either.
I'm sure we have. That feels like a Patreon.
I guess let us know if we haven't told you yet. We'll reveal it on the next exclusive we do together.
It's gonna be that should be the first thing we do after the paywall. We'll be like, okay, now we're going behind the paywall. Cut. Like,
yeah. And then we say, because I feel like I would remember. I don't think I know what you are.
I feel like I've cataloged this information about most of my friends. At the same time, we're going to do it on this exclusive and be like, oh, we've definitely talked about this on a normal episode.
It was like the central theme of that episode. Okay, let's check out this is Jake Lester from 2013, 684 views since then. These two little lads go on about neighborhoods for almost 19 bloody minutes. Ugh. But I'm going to skip ahead to, what is the song called again? Fighting the Gravity.
Yeah.
1424. All right, let's hear what these blokes have to say.
It's not one that I enjoy. No. Then we have Fighting the Gravity, which is...
Fighting the Gravity.
But I really...
So weird is Fighting the Gravity.
I love Fighting the Gravity. Weird. It's so creepy.
It's trippy.
It's like...
It's spacey. It's trippy.
It's like, whoa, dude.
Don't say it. Don't say the incantation.
Oh, no.
I just don't like it.
Flea is coming for you.
Like, it's a nice experimental sort of song where they've obviously tried some new stuff out, and I think it's turned out well, but Jake doesn't.
No.
That's what happens when you try and experiment, and, you know, good on him for doing it.
Well, yeah, I guess. Good on him for experimenting, but in this case, it didn't really work out. But
I think we have seen these kids before.
True, yeah, it's a really bad pre-song to it. Which, and Even If She Falls, is the last song, isn't it? Last song on the album. Well, on the deluxe album, so...
It's so good.
They are saying the same stuff as us, pretty much.
Yeah, in the same cute accents. Oh, this kid is like 12. He's got a Clockwork Orange poster on his wall. It's great.
There's a little poem in the background on the wall as well. What does that say?
If people were...
Something. I was drinking, and the was Harriet. So that's that classic... classic saying that we all know.
That we all know and love.
Exactly. Okay.
I believe it's biblical, right?
Yeah, I think it is. It's from the Apocrypha, actually. These kids offered us nothing. That was a waste of time.
And that sounds even more relatable.
Exactly. Okay. Up next, I don't know if this is any good or not, but I thought I'm going to play it. This is somebody turned... clips from Batman Begins into a Fighting the Gravity music video.
Ooh.
So.
Wait, I think I accidentally closed the watch together.
Oh, listen, Sam.
I'm sorry, there's too many windows, man. Now I'm like responsible on my side. It's I wasn't
built
for this.
You just have to keep the tab open.
I'm here. I know it was an accident. Okay, it's playing now.
My God. This song sucks.
Man, I forgot that they literally just swapped out Katie Holmes for Maggie Gyllenhaal in the middle of this Christopher Nolan Batman trilogy.
Yeah. It does make no sense about that. What kind of name is Cillian, eh?
Is it Irish?
I mean, I guess. Probably, but...
I can't tell if he's, like, really handsome... like normal like handsome
or just like terrifying handsome,
yeah, or like kind of like Buscemi kind of cool looking. Oh, right on. Okay, so he's doing his like spooky scarecrow thing when the song gets real crazy. This is basically just listening to the song while you and I watch clips from Batman Begins.
I know, what's wrong with that? I hate this part of the song.
Man, Batman Begins fucking sucks. Most of it is just Liam Neeson, I think, pretending to be Japanese.
Yeah, seems like it. Why is this song like trying to be so vibey?
I kind of like it now, though. Now that it's happening to Batman Begins. Oh, hold on. You stopped it right when we were getting like, yeah, shirtless Patrick Bateman.
This song like sounds like the lava lamp wall at Spencer's Gifts.
What weight do you think whatever his name Patrick Bateman is now?
What
do you think he's big or little?
Oh. Well, cause didn't he get big for like to play Dick Cheney or something?
Yeah, I feel like the last time I saw him in a movie, he was big for McKay. But I bet he's little again for something now.
Probably. Good question.
For some reason, like I know all actors like suck and are horrible and are probably shitty people and yada yada yada. For some reason, it was him right where there was like the him like. Screaming at the crew on set, like recording, And, like, that one actually bummed me out. I was like, that's too bad. And also, like, you imagine, like, maybe you can be a dick in your private life or be a dick to the press or whatever, but, like, don't be rude to the crew. Like, I found that really distressing. More distressing than when I think he beat up his mom, actually. I guess he's a pretty bad dude.
Have we talked about that before when he freaked out on the set of that? Was that a Terminator movie?
Yeah, he was in one of the bad Terminator movies.
That's what it was when he was freaking out and saying, "Are you professional?" And then the May She turned that into a great song. So a friend of the show, Jacob Safari, used to be in the May She, and they had this song called "Are You Professional" that they turned that rant into the sick song. Have we played that before?
I don't so think funny. So. Oh, man, there's a video of that rant? I thought it was just the sound.
The
this is great.
Are you doing?
No, they just lined it up with the...
Are you professional or not?
Oh, yeah.
Are you professional? By the
way,
Chief.
No! Shut the fuck up. Are you
professional? This is good as hell. Are you professional? This is fucking good as hell. Also a real great video of just all of the Bale, you know, greatest hits.
Fuck's sake, man, you're amateur.
You're amateur. Yeah, it keeps going with lots
Empire
of them.
Empire of the Sun. Oh, what a weird Bale's hit some fucking someone. Big hits, though.
Are you professional? Like, come on. That's such a narc question.
It is. It's true. I think that that's what really bothers you is the nature of the question.
Yeah.
Well, and then it makes you sound like a narcotics officer.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is a drug podcast now.
It turns out, man. God, nothing is worse.
There's a lot of those, hey?
It's just more than nothing. It's like when we do the streams, and I'm like, I'm having a drink. And I'm like, just got to stop talking about anything that goes in or comes out of my body. Like, just doesn't, no one benefits from that
discourse.
Well,
the things that come out of your body are still good to talk about, I think.
Not all of them.
Okay, so... Up next, if you'll allow it, I got to go off topic for a second because this came out.
We watched like half of a My She video because we were talking about Christian Bale. Yeah, man, go fucking crazy. I mentioned this to you before we started recording. All of my friends are watching Titanic sort of right now in a group chat. So the longer the pod goes, the less Titanic I will end up watching tonight. So,
right. So you want this to, either way, you're on a sinking ship, my friend.
Oh, wow. That was good. That was really good, man.
For some reason, searching for the song made me discover, I think this is a single called CAC Blink 182. I don't really know what this is.
What is happening?
It's like it was uploaded very recently. I've realized now with our new method, I have to open these things in two different tabs. This is uploaded by
two tabs for your two headphones.
Exactly. Operazia Plastilin is the band, I guess. I don't know. You should. I'm gonna
it's
play.
It's really
it.
Hard to like read that logo.
Yeah, but I mean the picture also is like so bad. There's someone drinking. Some sort of white water bottle milk that says, I think, FOP on it, maybe?
Yeah. So it's like the band looks like they're on stage or at a house show or something. And you can really only see, you can see sort of the guitar player's arm. You can see someone's got their foot up on the kick drum. But the only two people you can really see are the bass player, right? Who's definitely got a...
Yeah.
There's too many strings on that bass, I think. And he's in like an undershirt. He's got a man bun.
He's wearing a wallet chain with, I think, sweatpants.
I was going to say those were white jeans.
Oh, maybe.
So anyway, either just, you know, that's what you're looking at. And then sort of in the foreground is what I would assume is the singer, because they're at the front, is a woman just...
Wearing like a rockabilly store, like back of the shop sale section dress,
yeah,
skirt.
Yeah. just pouring milk into her mouth, and it is cascading down.
I need to...
It's really vile looking. Like, it doesn't... Just to be clear, I think there's a chance that description makes it sound like they're trying to do something sexual, and I assure you it does not look remotely sexual. Like, it looks way more like it's from Alien.
Well, also, like, the when it's a small thumbnail, it kind of looks like a normal single art, but then when it's kind of blown up, it's really grainy and feels very illegal looking, if that makes sense. Like,
yeah,
it looks very sketchy.
Yeah, that's fair. But, like, again, not sketchy in a way where you're like, who did this and why? It's not... I don't know if the... It's weird, man. It's very, very strange.
Yeah, it's sketchy in the way where it's like, if I click this video, are they going to find other band camps of mine that they can log into and delete?
Yeah, I'd be concerned as hell if I were you.
Okay, but I think this is a Russian song about Blink-182, maybe.
Mm, okay, I'm interested.
I mean, what are the... Oh, there, they said it. Do you hear that?
Yeah, cock. Blink-182, are they saying? Are they saying that Blink-182 is cock, huh?
Oh, yeah. There's a rap part?
Wow, like the chorus, I was gonna say, kind of sounded like Heart Sounds. But Heart Sounds is not a rap.
I don't know what that is.
It's very fast.
I'm asking Mila, who I mentioned in the start of the episode, because she's from Russia originally. She might be able to explain this to us.
Ooh,
she's online. So much more musical than anything Blink-182 normally.
I know. Imagine if this was what 9 sounded like.
Cock Blink-182. What does the word cack mean?
I don't know.
Oh, it translates to such as. So the thing we're saying, such as Blink-182.
Like Blink-182. I bet the chorus is like, we're gonna rock the people, we're gonna do a bunch of psychedelics like Blink-182. I mean, this band is big enough that they have a reasonably beefy entry on like Russian Wikipedia.
What does it say? Also, this, like, the song, they didn't upload it. It's one of those ones where it's uploaded as a topic. It was provided to YouTube by National Digital Aggregator LLC, which again is just like, I'm reaching for my wallet right now. Also, this link you just sent me is fucking insane.
But I think it works. So the name translates roughly to Russianly to Operation Plasticine. They're of course from Tambov, the center of Russia's pop punk community. Initially, the ideological leaders of the project, that's I know that's a translation thing, but I fucking love how Russian that is. I mean, every band does have an ideological leader.
That's true.
So and Toli Tesarev and Svetlana Berlaka, who left the group in 2010. The early work of Operation Plasticine is punk rock of the 90s generation. I mean, I'm sold. In 2009, the team changed its name to Mama and recorded another studio album. Okay, so, you know, I'm getting a little bit Google translated here, but, you know, I feel like we've learned a lot.
I think I found the lyrics that have also been translated, so they might be wrong, but this is what I'm reading. To hell with this. I'm going to send it to you so you can read it along, because okay. I might start giggling throughout this, but you got to click English on here. To hell with all this nonsense bustle. I will gather a group and go on tour. I will choose whiskey. I will fill a couple of tattoos, and I'll be like Blink one night and that. I think that's supposed to say Blink 182. To hell with all this nonsense bustle.
This is sick, though.
I will gather a group and go on tour. I will believe in my childhood dream. I'll be back on the shield with zero on the account. Yeah, that's so good.
Yo, this song fucking rocks.
And then the verse where he's rapping, finish joking. I've been tormenting for 10 years. I've been studying for 10 years. I dance, grimace, sing, and scream. And everything seems to work out. But what? I did everything the way I feel. Haters spit on a dick.
Oh, yeah, yo, that's good. I'm going to adopt that.
And to those who loved, return triple. I love you. So this is what? Spring 2020, only 4 concerts. OP, 10 years. We will go on stage and steal your heart. March 7th. They announced their tour dates in here?
No, I think, March 7th, Minsk, 14th, Kiev, 21, Moscow, 28, Peter. I think this might be mashing up. This might be... crawling some disparate, disparate pieces of information are sort of being mashed together on this website.
Man, yeah, to okay. hell with Mila, all this giving nonsense, bustle. Mila's giving me a translation that's about the same.
Okay.
And she said, she literally just said it's killing her because the rap verse, they're dropping dates and cities of their tour. So that's not like a typo. They're literally...
Oh, that's real. Yo, this band fucking rocks.
Imagine well, think this. About it. That's probably been canceled.
Oh, that's true.
She said so Moscow on the 21st.
Song. Oh, my God. Yeah, this song came out on January 13th. This is so fucking sad.
They started this whole song just to go on tour.
They wrote a song about the tour that they were going to go on.
Yeah, Mila's translation is, we're gonna form a group and go on tour, and then the... And then at the end of the course, they rhyme with that and say, we're going to live out our dreams and be just like Blink-182.
Oh, man. I'm, like, legitimately so sad for this rock group.
I guess, like, maybe it's because it's good to make plans, but at the same time, we got to live one day at a time. Sure, announce your tour date somewhere where you can edit the post if you need to. But don't announce them in a song that you've written and mixed and mastered and released.
Oh. I wish Prenup and Junior Battles had like rap parts where we're like, you know, March 14th, Bovine, not doing a lot till November. Then we might play a show. Maybe.
Yeah.
January. We're going to go to Montreal because our friends told us we could use their gear.
Prenup would be like, September, Tubby Dog. February 15th, Tubby Dog. April, really don't want to play this show, but they need an opener and they're our friends. Tubby Dog.
Man, this is, you know, like from time to time, like, I don't know about you, but like just the, you know, starting to, you know, settle into a routine and, you know, get work done and get distracted a lot. And, you know, it's, I think normal shit everyone's going through, but there's like these weird things that all hit me where I'm like, fuck, it's crazy that this is actually like the reality that we're living through right now. Like, you know, one was, you know, I think the first time I saw like an empty sort of streets of Paris, you know, all the way to the Eiffel Tower. And I was like, that's fucking nuts, man. Seeing that, like, it's like a movie. And then today I was trying to remember which city the Junos were supposed to be held in Saskatchewan. The answer was Saskatoon. And so I, you know, looked it up. And on the Wikipedia page, it was like, you know, the 2020 Junos were an event that was supposed to be held in. And I was like, oh, damn, that's fucked up. It's a fucked up thing to read. And add to that now this Russian pop punk rap that's like, you know, 14th Kiev, 15th St. Petersburg, 16th Moscow, then back home. We're never going to die or get coronavirus. You're like, fuck, man.
Yeah, that's so sad. I also love how Sam Sutherland it is to be sad that the Junos are canceled.
No, that's not. That's really, I want to make this very clear. Now, listen, I a lot of people work hard on that. And that is actually how I feel. However, it was more the idea of like, yo, there are going to be a lot of Wikipedia entries that will be sort of written in that weird tense of like past tense, the way that you write when someone like you have to, someone dies and immediately someone logs onto Wikipedia and is like, you know,
changes it all. Yeah, that's true.
RIP, the guy from Fountains of Wayne was like that kind of thing, which happened right before we started recording.
True. Yeah.
And like,
trying to think of some sort of joke about fountains, like the water was turned off or something.
No. but like, there's just something with the idea of like, there's going to be a lot of events you know, albums, movies, like things that like just aren't going to happen that will forever be written about in this like weird, like.
But even cooler than that, and stranger than that, and more interesting than that is that what will. Well, that's not interesting at all.
I want to make that fuck. I know will, that's not interesting.
But what will continue to happen is a weekly 2.5 hour analysis of a Blink 182 song that no one likes.
I think that is important to remember. Is that so, you know, the world is still turning and the pod is still podding.
So I got a little update from my Flea thread.
What's up?
I asked Flea if he had heard Fighting the Gravity. He has not written back. But somebody named Luke Sims, 99, has. Luke Sims is an HR professional / content strategy nerd, according to his Twitter bio. And he wrote to me, "This song is 8 years old," was his reply, being a little bit of a snarkman, or so I thought. Because somebody replied to him and said, "But have you heard it?" All caps. And Luke Sims replied and said, "Oh, no. Oh, it's no doubt still a banger, but I think it has only reinforced Flea's original. Flea's original point more. I wish this kind of music was still being made on a more mainstream level, at least."
Okay, so at the very least, we could say that this episode features Luke Sims.
Yeah, exactly. Which is close.
Totally.
Yeah, so, okay, the best thing is not only
Luke Sims, by the way, is an HR professional content strategy nerd from Calgary, which is...
He's from Calgary?
Yeah.
Even better.
So congrats.
Oh my god. That's so good. Yeah, beautiful shot of the skyline on you as you're
very, very proud of Calgary.
So not only do we have a Russian tour date anthem... in this episode, there's some magic with this one, because this is not the next thing I'm going to show you is straight up not off topic in any way, because it's completely on topic, because this is this is called
what? No, you're not allowed to do this. This is illegal.
This is called B-Link, Fighting the Gravity extended version by B-Link, and this man I cannot begin to describe to everyone sort of the local nightclub of a small town IT guy energy that like this smells like dollar store cologne, this single art.
Oh yeah. Ashley, how's Titanic?
That's great. They were saying there's some joke about To the Stars to tell you.
Oh, okay. Let me know.
Yeah.
sorry, just checking in. So B-Link, is this a does he know?
I don't think he knows.
Does like Kenora's own B-Link know?
Wait, did you actually figure out where he's from? Because I would love to know.
No, I'm just saying when you said small town DJs, I'd be like Friday night, like you know all the you know corrections officers hit levels. Yeah.
But like even the gradient behind this man, like obviously I'm going to have to post this because it needs to be seen to be believed.
No, I don't know, man. It's kind of unbelievable.
This is another one of those ones that's auto-generated by YouTube, uploaded from some music service, but this has only 6 views. I didn't listen to it yet. I just saw the picture and was like, we're talking about this. So let's listen to B-Link's extended version of Fighting the Gravity featuring Addie Nicole. Okay, it sounds like what I thought it would sound like. This does feel like a joke from the British Office or something. He's like his way of looking directly into the camera but doing the pose where it looks like he's leaning back to back with someone.
Yeah, but no friends. I found this SoundCloud, and just for the record, B-Link is a DJ and producer in multiple styles, worked with many big DJs, and is really working on an international career.
Oh my god, every photo of B-Link is so good.
B-Link, of course, is from Shoeworld. Netherlands.
Do you think the B-Link All-Star Moonbaton remix is Smash Mouth?
I think we gotta find out. You could be, I just wanna check. You could still be racist against the Dutch, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you can be, to be honest with you, you can be racist against whoever you want. It's just there's going to be some fallout.
Right, know? Yeah, yeah, that's true. Freedom of speech is not freedom from consequence. I understand that.
Okay, this is B-Link All-Star Remix.
You can download this track by B-Link for free and without this intro by pressing the
it's not, hold on, it's not playing. Oh, here
below.
We go. Did you hear that intro? No, I missed it. Start it again. Start it again. I didn't have the window open. It just started from
this track.
Okay, okay,
you can
okay.
Download this track by B-Link for free and without this intro by pressing the free download button below.
Wow. Okay. Baked in pre-roll.
Bookings,
tight.
Visit B-Link.com.
B-Link.com. Time for a new tab, baby. Yeah, it is.
Oh, ho, ho.
But if he knows, oh, this website's not secure. I'm here though, B-Link.
Somebody won't tell
what
me
a
the
song,
world
hey?
Is gonna roll
this,
me. I ain't
like,
the sharpest tool
not in
the shed.
Context in a long time.
She was looking
it's
kind of dumb
it's really
with
good.
Her
I think it's getting to the point where I actually have hurt feelings that they won't come on the pod though.
It's well, fucking rude, man. Coming and they don't stop coming. Oh, yeah, I'm not tell you, someone else turned down the pod today, who I kind of thought should have said yes to it.
So much to see, so what's wrong with thinking the back streets?
Phil Elborn loved doing the pod.
Yeah, you can do that with the pod.
Hey now, and he's going to stop. Get your game on.
This is a kind of remix.
Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on. Get paid now.
Let's start a. After we're done with Blink, let's do B-Link 155.
Yeah, people keep asking what's next, and it's that.
I'm worried about I'm worried about covers because I feel like there's no way that. Just even to start off, there's no way, I guess, that we're going to do better than B-Link or Operation Plasticine.
No, that's the thing. It's like you kind of hit it out of the park. Should we just stop?
We should, but we're not going to.
Okay, because Titanic is about to sink.
So now you want to watch Titanic.
Well, because all the good stuff's about to happen. All the guy who hits the propeller. If I miss the guy who hits the propeller to listen to like a fifth acoustic version of Fighting the Gravity. Oh, boy. This is going to be trouble.
I was kind of thinking, too, like there's no way that this Nightcore version is going to be good. But we have to.
I do feel like just a little piece of something that makes me smile and might make you smile before you should play this cover as soon as I'm done, which is that even though I feel like, you know, Ashley has probably seen this movie a few times, she's having, a fairly good time because her favorite genre of movies is boats sinking. And this has been like a long hill.
So isn't this pretty much just the one?
No, oh my god, dude! There's a lot of movies where boats sink.
Really? I mean, like what else?
Well, okay, so A Night to Remember, which is also a movie about the Titanic, that's on Criterion Channel. There's of course the Poseidon Adventure, and then the remake Poseidon with Richard Dreyfuss. I'm sure that you know Jaws is basically a boat sinking movie.
I guess that's true. So that's her. That's her genre.
That's her genre is a boat sinking.
So is she loving this right now?
I think it's once the love story gets out of the way and that boat starts going down. Like I went back when we both took a bio break. I was like, yo, what's up? And she's like, boat sinking. I was like, oh shit, that's exciting. So it's really things are heating up there.
All right. Well, that's good to hear. I think things are going to heat up for us too in a similar sort of. Tragic and disastrous sort of pace.
Yeah.
Let's see how this song translates as a Nightcore song.
Which one of us is going to like take their clothes off and paint the other one?
We should do that. We should draw each other naked while we pod.
We should
once we do the big circumcision reveal.
Right, yeah. Or maybe the next live event should be like just like a life drawing workshop. Do you think all the covers are just going to have the vibes for a minute off the top?
I mean, only one way to find out. Does this even sound like Nightcore to you?
No, this like barely sounds like a fast punk song, right? Okay, actually, it's good.
Now it just sounds like a like European kids movie, like animated movie that's really boring and bad. Like ripping off the Smurfs or something.
Right, yeah.
All the worker guys are like singing this.
See, like, this is fucking cool. Oh, and then the song happens. So the first, like, minute and a half of the song is good.
It's not good at
it
all.
It is, though. It's a vibe in search of a song.
Okay, that's great.
Fuck, this song fucking sucks, eh?
It's so bad.
Oh, god damn.
Well, let's just fucking keep it
moving. Let's keep it going, man. Just fucking...
But, so here, because it's a neighborhood, when we got to hear these guys do their fucking little pop-punk game with it. You know, they love that they've made it pop-punk, and they're so clever about it. So it's Future Idiots.
Sounds like an Angels Network song.
It does sound a lot better, actually, already. Okay, this one actually sounds a lot better.
It's just like, kind of crossed my arms.
Something's spinning in my blood. Something's flying in my brain. When I'm smothered from the blood, I can't recognize your face. I need to use a just drive.
This is how the song goes.
Burning lights on the street of fire. Fighting the gravity. Fighting the gravity. Fighting the gravity. When I'm beaten, defeated, they'll take you away from me.
This is how I get groomed into becoming a fest guy. It's like you make me listen to this after I've listened to something so horrible, and then I'm like, oh, this is really good. But then all of a sudden, does that mean I like this shit? I fucking hope not.
I think you do. This is you're gonna get a stress face tattoo.
What does that mean?
It's the,
is that a Rage Comics kind of thing?
It's sort of. It's like the Fest Punk version of a Rage comic. It's like the No Idea Records logo.
Oh, yeah, that. Okay. Oh, that has a name? That's...
The Stress Face, yeah. Come on, man. Now that you're a Fest Punk, you got to know.
I got to know these things. What else do I have to know? I mean, ultimately, I think being a Fest Punk is just like being able to pretend really well. So I'm already halfway there.
Yeah, it's true. It's great, great punk theater.
All right. Similarly to that one, I think this is also someone trying to turn it into a pop punk song. This is Bless the Fall 89, but it's all spelled with like weird shit on YouTube. You can take a look right here.
But like, this is going to have the whole fucking intro, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, maybe I'll skip ahead.
Okay, now it sounds like a Tea Party song.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
For non-Canadians wondering, this is the band that I was... And in this sense, maybe it sounds even more like an acid trip.
Does Fall sound like the Tea Party sometimes?
Yeah. With this fire in the
world. This kind of just like shreds over the song.
Stay. Silence. No, fuck, that's good.
It's not even the what if it had a guitar solo guy, it's a different guy.
So, someone in the comments is asking for tabs. Can you imagine trying to fucking tab that out?
Just noodling under this shit. The fact that this guitar solo A fits with this and B isn't even the most jarring thing that I hear right now is a bad sign.
Also, I'm really confused by the comments because there are two that reference the song Wolves. Like, I didn't realize how the intro does sort of sound like Wolves. And then someone else saying, why didn't you do the part that sounds like Wolves? Like, what Wolves do they... I'm just thinking of, like...
Wolves?
I'm a fixed wolves?
Yeah, I'm thinking about a fixed wolves. Still one of the greatest tweets of all time now.
Part about this for me is that before entering quarantine, I was getting so close to buying a guitar again after not having one for so long. And I know that if I had bought it, I just would have put it in the corner and continued to play Call of Duty Warzone. But this is making me want a noodle so bad, even though it sounds like dog shit.
Yeah, hold on. I'm trying to find some real sick tea party to share with everyone, but. Oh, yeah, here it is. Okay. Okay, hold on. Let's just give people a taste of Fire in the Head, because I feel like this is like something that... I'm trying to play it from a certain time. Play it around like 1:15, because I feel like you get some guitar solo there. Just like I really feel like we conjured it, and I think it's super important that people who don't live in Canada and are not 35 years old...
There is some pod magic brewing this week, I think.
I feel like. Bit. I mean, there's an energy. I guess I could put it in there. Right? Oh my god, this is so disgusting. How good is this song? Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh, how many strings is that? That's gotta be like fucking 18. Oh. Oh, buddy.
This is what Canada is like.
This was one of the biggest bands in this country. And just picture an evil magician sort of singing this to you sensually. Oh, yeah. Okay, we could stop listening to Fire.
They've always got such
cool
Mellotrons in the background, too, but they're putting them on such shitty songs, so it just sounds like garbage.
Have you seen what the Tea Party drummer looks like these days, by the way?
Of course I have. Where? How would I have...
Oh, buddy, you're going to love... You can picture the Tea Party drummer, right?
No, I can't.
Okay, hold on. Fuck. Okay, watch Fire in the Head for 2 seconds more while I find the... Like, just play it. People can listen to it. And just focus on the drummer, who's just like a normal kind of 90s... like alt rock drummer guy.
Oh, this is so disgusting. Yeah. Everyone listening, what do you think of this music?
Always in time. Okay, now look at what the drummer looks like now.
He's too blurry. I haven't seen him once yet because there's all these 90s effects going on. And just like weird like theater company in the desert vibes.
It's true. It's like they've gone to the desert to stage Richard III.
By the way, oh my god, he looks so good. Wow, he looks amazing now.
He's basically like got like the worst version of like a 70s mod cut. It's so
bad.
Yeah,
he looks
bad.
Like a Welland, as we were mentioning recently. Paul yeah, Weller, yeah. Bellend look. But he also has like a fake tan, and then that's exacerbated by his like Kraft Dinner orange sunglasses that he has on.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really good. By the way, speaking of theater companies, I really glossed over it so quickly last week because I was trying to be sensitive when you were telling me about your sort of Macklemore origin story. But I wanted to know, like, how trained in dance are you?
Oh, right. Not. I'm unfortunately extremely not. I took jazz for a number of years, but none of it really, none of it stuck.
Okay.
You know?
What does that mean, jazz dancing, though?
I don't really know. It was
like
a lot.
Like La La Land?
Yeah, no, I guess like there's a lot of like sashaying is really all I remember is just really sashaying good. For days.
I was interested in tap dancing when I was a little kid, but because of Looney Tunes cartoons, I wanted to tap dance and then get yanked off with a cane. And I think definitely I have been chasing that feeling of getting yanked off with a cane my whole life in different ways, but
yeah, that's absolutely true.
Not through tap, unfortunately. Okay. Since we're just kind of, there's still a lot to go here, but we're busting through the kind of the more predictable ones. So we're going to play, Odie Acoustic next with his take on Fighting the Gravity. Michael Showalter back, baby.
Oh man, Showalter's in an episode of The Grinder, which I cannot recommend enough as a quarantine show that you recommended to me, even though I know you hate recommendations.
But then you told me that I actually give good recommendations, which is like the highest honor, because people give dog shit recommendations usually.
No, yeah, you do. Credit where credit's due, you're a good recommender.
I am still mad at Odie for like asking us to send him stats about the pod and then just never writing us back again.
Here's a stat, Odie, you're a fucking dickhead.
Although, this sounds really nice.
Oh, I love him. I can never hate Odie. I need to leave,
so just drive. You really turned me on a pin there. Burning lights on the street, I'm fighting the gravity. He's so sensitive.
I think that's why I like him so much, because I'm also sensitive. We relate to each other.
You're sashaying to this right now?
Yeah, I just can't see it. I'm carrying the microphone around the ring with me. I'm always fighting gravity.
It's pretty, it's just interesting to see how easy it would have been to turn it into like a song that doesn't sound like absolute dog shit. Like there still seems to be some sort of song there, even if it's not that great.
Yeah, weirdly, I didn't think that was as good. I was worried after the Future Idiots thing, like that I had sort of, like I had seen the magic eye image and now it was always going to look like a schooner to me.
Man, see, I can't do magic eyes anymore, and I was good at them as a boy.
I could only do them by crossing my eyes, and then I would see it inverted, and so you couldn't ever tell what it was.
Did you ever go to McDonald's, and they had McDonald's-themed magic eyes up at McDonald's in the play area? The one in Abbotsford had that, and they also had, like, a N64 station, which was, like, the greasiest place on Earth. Like, just, like, you just eat fries and play N64.
Man, honestly, if, like, there's, you know, we talk a lot about, like, hopefully we can get this together, you know, get it together quickly, take care of each other, and this sort of pandemic is over, you know, sooner rather than later. You know, there hopefully are going to be some good things that are going to come from it. You know, perhaps sort of more and more people understanding in the States the importance of, you know, universal healthcare, perhaps an implementation of some form of universal basic income along with a robust social safety net, not at the expense of one. But the idea of not having an N64 station at a fucking McDonald's is like, that is a number one just in terms of that's things that absolutely shortened the lifespan of people in the Abbotsford area.
Yeah, exactly. It's one of those things where I'm like, did I dream this up? But other people have corroborated that it was real. No. You like play Banjo-Kazooie and then just kind of like dip your hand in grease and then grab the controller again. That's kind of cool.
That's so
maybe
vile.
We should bring it back. Anyways, someone's taken that Odie acoustic cover. This is JJR, and he's decided to drum along to that.
Oh, cool.
So he's just set up his electronic drums in the corner of this closet that he lives in.
He's playing them like real drums, though. He's got flair. He's flipping the sticks around.
That's true. Is there not a way to make electronic drums sound better? Disgusting. See, this song is, there's dark energy to this song.
Yeah.
It's a bad song.
I can't believe Future Idiots were like the one redeeming thing so far about this episode.
I know. That's kind of fucked. Well, also, obviously, Operation Plasticine. Yeah. I think this next one might be good, though. I have a good feeling about this guy, Jedmond Fish, is his name.
Jedmond Fish is not the name of this Ethan Hawke's cousin-looking motherfucker.
Yeah, this is, like, definitely some UGC from a college movie. I haven't listened to this one either. I just saw the Max Res default and I was like, yep, this one's staying in. This is Jedmond Fish. He has quite a few subscribers actually. This is uploaded in 2012. I mean, it's almost hard to describe. He looks like a crisis actor because his clothing and room is so generic that it looks like it's been crafted by the deep state in a way.
It's true. If I saw this kid on the news, like I already am finding QAnon theories more and more persuasive as this video plays in the background.
Yeah, exactly.
And this video is absolutely radicalizing me.
You named him Jedmond Fish and you thought we'd believe you?
Yeah. Oh, the American public is not a fool.
Here's Jedmond Fish with this song. He's wearing some sort of like very thin striped hoodie that's like only existed in 2007.
Well, if we wanted the back of shirts, he's actually selling some via his YouTube and a website called Spreadshirt.com, which honestly is vile.
He's got some nice gruffness to his voice, though.
Yeah. Jedmond.
He, like, uses it. He does something with his mouth that's very 90s looking. The way that he, like, sort of shapes his lips while he sings. I don't know how to explain it. That honestly truly made me like the song a little bit more. Jedmond Fish did.
I'm just trying to get a sense of Jedmond Fish's deal. So, you know, he's listed as he says he's an imaginative educator and the author of Orca's Eye. And Orca's Eye, turns out, is a work of fiction written by the same Jedmond, all about a man named Jeremiah Drake. Who I believe goes through a tough time in his life and contemplates suicide. And then he's made a video on the same channel of the immersive audio experience of this book, Orca's Eye Skylines, featuring that guy. And it says it's for his students.
Oh, wow. So he's Mr. Fish.
Mr. Fish. But you can call me Jedmond.
He's also got a podcast called Positive Reinforcement. I mean, so you sent me a 3-hour. Let's listen to the whole Orca's Eye Skyline. I mean, hang on. This is for his students, and it's written and produced by Justin Norris, what you've just said. Do you think that he's just pirated this audiobook?
No, I think that Justin Norris and Jedmond Fish are, in fact, the same person.
You think that's his pen name?
That's what I think. I think that, I mean, it's hard to say whether Jedmond Fish is like a nom de rock, or if...
Given situation.
Oh, I skipped ahead a little.
Nothing left to do. The sound of blaring horns permeated wow. the air around him, and the street seemed to narrow.
Do you think that's Jedmond's voice?
I don't think gas. So.
I think he's pirating shit for his students. Sidewalk to avoid. I think Jedmond's a content thief.
Wow.
He's also uploaded the Lord of the Flies audiobook. I mean, there's no rules with Jedmond Fish.
Wow. You know what? Jedmond Fish has real Kaiser Soze. Like, just like it's something you can all adopt or something, you know, maybe more like Spartacus, where we're all Jedmond Fish now.
Je suis Jedmond Fish. You can't just say Jedmond, though. You have to say Jedmond Fish, unfortunately.
Oh, yeah. Jedmond Fish is deserving of the respect of constantly stating his full name.
He's done quite a few Blink covers over the years. He also has a video called Vegas 2014! !! Where he's wrapping his big mouth around a big novelty drink. Jedmond Fish is another treat that we can't be forgotten in the ether of this episode, which has been given us so much, actually.
That's true.
So much more than I ever anticipated,
What's your like dandruff situation like over there under quarantine?
What?
I'm just like, I'm dry in ways that I never have been. You know, like obviously the hands, I haven't shaved. I'm trying to grow out a beard again. It's not working, but it's just I'm covered in, like when I went to the bathroom earlier, just covered in, every part of me is covered in dandruff.
My dandruff has been, I mean, this has been a theme over the course of the show. I stopped washing my hair for a while
right.
and to avoid having dandruff. And then I found this tar shampoo that worked. It's just like literally tar. And I can't find it in Montreal. And so I've tried a different, like I bought like a $30 bottle of shampoo during quarantine while I was stocking up. And it doesn't really work that well. I mean, the flakes have stopped, but my head is itchy all the time. But
I'm always inside. Gone. I'm fucking dying here. Anyway, it's fine. At me on Twitter if you're also experiencing dryness in new and exciting ways.
Okay, up next we've got Jeremy Asuncion. I think we've seen this guy before, and he rules.
This looks familiar.
He's wearing a South Park shirt. I think he's playing like a half. It's like a half acoustic.
It also.
He has these like are definitely the
chords.
Strumming.
These are the chords to bro him also.
Yeah, and he's like playing it like bro. He's making a bro him face while he plays it. He's also turned off the comments on this video.
He's just smiling though.
The caption says, "Do I sound like Mark Hoppus? What can you say about my guitar playing?" But the comments are turned off. Jeez.
Be careful what you wish for.
This makes no sense. Oh, this makes
I
no
love
sense.
Him.
This makes no sense. This
he's like
no.
literally smiling as he sings.
Yeah, and he's doing all the dumb guitar
things.
This
makes no sense. This makes no sense. This makes no sense. This makes no. This makes no sense, this makes no sense, this makes no sense, this makes no. This makes no sense, this makes no sense, this makes no sense, this makes no.
It's also a very cool acoustic guitar that definitely has like some sort of like, you know, tribal flame tattoo sticker attached to it. And then like both of the, I don't know, the carved out, I don't know anything about guitars, but basically like it's got the scooped out body on both sides, so it kind of looks like a sick electric guitar.
So you can shred at the top?
Yeah, so you can get your head around, your hands around both sides of the neck.
And also, like, the way this is filmed looks like it's like some Red Giant effects or something. It looks like fake VHS.
Yeah,
because
yeah, yeah.
The camera's so shitty.
It looks really pretentious.
I like that one a lot. That's a really good version of the song. I love Jeremy Asuncion. He's cool.
He's cool.
I think, okay, yeah, this, we don't normally play the drum covers, but this one I just feel like had some chaotic energy off the start. This is.
Is it outdoors?
It's not outdoors, but it's Benjamin Carroll. It kind of looks like he's in like a makeshift like bunker TV studio. Like there's like gray carpet on the wall. I don't really get where he is. He's wearing like a kind of cool Adidas three stripes, like dad at soccer practice shirt. And the video starts with him in the middle of a different song from the album. Like, it just, like, starts. He's, like, drumming like such a dad. Like, I don't know why he included so much of this. And then.
What a good song, though.
I know, but
and
like
then
a
it just
full
stops,
minute, and then he just like takes his hat off.
He's clearly really hot, like
yeah, he's like just but, covering his sweat on himself.
But there's a fan right behind him that is not turned on, like a huge floor fan.
He's
just sitting
like,
idle.
He just kind of does maybe a bar and a half of hitting the hi-hat and then switches to a different cymbal, just willy nilly.
Oh yeah,
he's rocking it. Oh, he's making some stanky drum faces. Ooh. I love it.
This man is playing those drums.
This song is so bad.
Yeah.
Here's the part you like.
All these you're trying to damn me with that. Here's the part you like.
Okay. Yeah. Well.
Sorry.
Don't like things.
I don't mean to.
Oh, this is the one I was trying to play earlier. Not the guitar solo guy, although that was ridiculous. But this is Punky Gaz is his name. And it's Punky Gaz, and he's doing a Punky Gaz version of the song. There's a little intro on his channel, which is kind of cool. And here we go, Punky Gaz. He took the slow, dreary song and punked it up a touch.
Yeah, these Gazes are punky.
Funky Gazza! You can't really save this part of the song.
Usually it's dead.
Something swimming in my
my blood, something's rotting in my brain. When I spot the from the flood, I can't recognize your face. I need to leave, so just drive, drive. Running lights on the street, and I'm fighting the gravity.
I feel like Future Idiots changed more of this song than we realized.
Yeah, more than Punky Gaz.
Yeah, Punky Gaz sucks again.
He sounds like a fast band to me, though.
Yeah, not all the fast bands are good, though.
Really?
I know, it's hard for me to say.
I think this guy has... I think Punky Gaz has the Blink Bunny racing stripe tattoo, though.
Okay, that's pretty good.
I mean, it's a bit better.
Credit where credit's due.
I appreciate that this man's... Probably his birth name is Punky Gaz, or maybe Punky Gazza, which is pretty good.
Punky Gazzer is good.
Okay. Oh my god, there's so many fucking gems this week. I forgot about this. This is so exciting. So this, I think we're gonna get lost in this too. This is uploaded by so many windows open. I'm dying.
Oh, this is the official drum cover.
This is the official drum cover uploaded by, yeah, the channel is just called Official Blink-182 Drum Covers. This is a drum cover performed by Patrick Tailsford Jr. Look at the day that this was uploaded. It was uploaded today, first of all, the magic of it. But not only that, it's not just that somebody hacked into my email because I was trolling them and saw what we were planning to do, but this person's been doing Blink-182 drum covers on YouTube for like 5 years, ultimately. 4 years, they go all the way back. But not only that, this official drum cover, like all the other ones on the channel,
is just what?
Doing blast beats.
Just doing blast beats?
Over the whole long intro, and then...
What the fuck? I mean, it's sick as hell.
It's an improvement, for sure, but... I'm just skipping ahead a little. Very steady blast.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if this is technically much of a blast beat either. It sounds like kind of a fake blast beat that, like, a band I would try to drum in.
Yeah, Def Heaven-ass blast beat.
Yeah, but, like, so I was curious... It like, is this just a bit? Is this someone who's been listening to the pod? But this predates the pod. And not only that, but like, let's check out like, I don't know. Well, let's do Dumpweed because that's the first upload on the channel. And I think it's the same kind of thing. This is from 2015, but the same person doing Dumpweed. And it, I think it's like a similar kind of, here's a little intro. Behind this guy's drum set, and he's just kind of doing this drill on repeat
while Dumpy plays. I honestly was like, do I have different windows open? Like, what the fuck is happening? That was making me feel quite nutty.
Let's check one more, just because I love this channel. We've been missing out. You want to pick one?
Yeah. Okay. Let's pick. I was going to say we should do the most popular, but maybe we should do a Josiah style and do the least popular, which appears to be their cover of Down. So this is my pick, is an homage to you.
Thank you. The song that... Oh, wait, I think... Do I like Down? Oh, yeah, it's Violence that I don't like.
Yeah.
I can't even remember.
Hard to keep track of your lies. Okay. Oh, what a tune. This, like, really high-quality intro, by the way. Like, really...
I know, this channel's
nice
art.
Motion graphics. And then this is, like... What the fuck is happening?
This okay. channel's so good.
So, okay, so... I think what's happened is... that put whatever they're shooting with, like, at the far end of a table or, like, a chair or something. And so what you have right now in the shot is about two-thirds of the screen is just blurry gray. And then there's this, like, one-third at the top that's a strip where you can kind of see the practice space where he's just playing that drill. And he's playing drums in the left-hand side of the frame. And then there's, I think, a mirror in the practice space so you can see, like, another tiny sliver of his body. But because you have no sense of the space, it's, like, deeply disorienting.
I'm really curious about the I Miss You one because it just shows a Fiji water bottle.
And it...
just a stick inside of an empty Fiji water bottle. This person, like, absolutely gets it. You know what I mean? Like, this person was waiting for us to find them all along.
Yeah, so just to be clear, there is not even drums in this photo. It looks like it's being filmed, you know, just... like, in an apartment complex somewhere. He's just... can we skip to the end?
Sure.
Yep, okay, so it's just thing. 4 minutes of that. Honestly, that would be hard to maintain. Okay, can we watch the All the Small Things one? Because that's the most popular.
I think this person is, like, a legit drummer, like a free jazz drummer or something.
Well, because when they're doing the drills are good. And again, like, all the framing is, like, so bad, but, like, sort of genius bad.
Yeah, exactly.
And then the intro graphics are, like, legitimately really just, like, kind of slick, like, After Effects Pro-looking graphics.
Does this one just never come in?
I hope so. Oh, that's...
Okay, I can promise you this right now that we're doing exclusively with this guy at some point because we needed him to walk us through his videos.
Oh my god. This is like... it's so actually funny.
I know. But also, like, sick, I think.
No, like, legitimately sick. I mean, obviously... okay, I think they clearly have a few of, like, one of our favorite genres, which is outdoor drum covers. And so maybe we should watch their cover of Shut Up. That was, of course, you know, a classic, you know, very emotional episode.
yeah, that's true.
And so once again, there's a real slick intro here. And for context, they're playing... sort of on the top of a rock, like just spray painted underneath a bunch of power lines, and there's, like, also, like, a woman sitting just on the edge of the frame, kind of not paying attention, and another guy kind of talking to her.
Because it presented to look so real. Like, it looks like a real drum cover when you look at the intro and the words. I love it.
Sorry, the top comment here is, I need an explanation. An official Blink-182 drum covers responding with the title of the video, Blink-182 Drum Covers Performed by Patrick Tailsforth Jr.
It's so good.
Sorry, the description, rather.
Oh my god. Okay,
holy shit.
The amazing thing about this song is it's not even the best cover that I found this week. That's the what I've saved for last year is the best one. And I'm pretty sure this is one of those special treats that was placed on YouTube just for us. Because
I can't believe that last channel is, like, kind of not for... maybe I wanted this to be for us because it's so fucking... like,
I know.
This is much
exactly.
funnier than me. I guess. This thing is cooler than me, so of course it's not. But how did they upload... neighbor, like, how did they do all, like, they uploaded, sorry, the entirety of Neighborhoods in drum covers just today.
Exactly. It's crazy. But not only that,
like, I thought it was just the one song.
The channel predates us, though, so that's the, like, It's like something is just in the air that we happen to
maybe,
tap into.
Maybe you, but I could never be part of the genesis of an idea that good. But that's neither here nor there. This you think was truly a treat left for us?
This one, I think so, because the name. So
oh yeah,
this okay. is from 2018. This is the name of the channel is the giveaway. This is uploaded by Scott Season.
Okay,
I mean it has to be right. There's it says, do you like Blink-182? Me too. And this is a music concrete version of Fighting the Gravity.
And this is the only video uploaded by this channel. So yeah, I feel like
it must be.
Yeah.
Okay. And it sounds like this.
And so the video that accompanies it is like a mash of like some like Mario font. It kind of like looks like maybe a screen cap from a band camp.
Yeah, there's like a word cloud of tags, but there's it's too small very scary for me. Face in the top oh. right as well.
Is that you? Hello. Is it me?
And also, for those of you who are not behind the paywall, patreon.com/blink155, Music Concrete is a form of music name dropped by none other than Larry Heather on the phone. So. This is really good.
This is up there with the Future Idiots one in terms of making me understand the song better.
Yeah, I agree. I gotta play the whole thing, sorry.
No, of course.
I think actually that's a screenshot of the sound effects they use from freesound.org in the middle.
Oh, okay.
It's not over yet.
I mean, this is better than the song.
Absolutely.
So this has 10 seconds left.
It is a cover of the song, so this has redeemed it, I think.
I think so. They've improved on the ideas and made it their own.
Yeah, so, I mean, okay. That's the cover. So.
That was, yes. You know, it's Scott Season, for sure, you know.
You get it. Whoever that was, you get it. And there's a lot of people who get it. I think my final thought is like, I still think I have to go with my beliefs. I have to not stray from the path, and I have to agree that with myself that this is the worst Blink-182 song ever. And I still stand by that. But as I suspected, the worst Blink-182 song ever has treated me to one of the most fun roller coaster rides of an episode in a long time. This kind of feels like a classic Blink-155 episode with all the weird things we found. So for that, I'm grateful.
That's, you know, I think a really positive way of looking at this. Look, the song is bad, but there's more interesting stuff around it that hung over you. So like, it's certainly not the worst. And that Future Idiots cover and the Scott Season Music Concrete reimagining, truly sort of redemptive interpretations that reminded me that, you know, at its heart, it's still a Blink-182 song and therefore still fundamentally good and worthwhile.
So take that, Flea. Rock ain't dead.
Yeah, so hold on. Take a look to see if there's any more Flea responses. This week I did the guest interview again, which is shocking.
Yeah, something strange in the air.
Listen, there's a bit more time. There's no dinners. And so I'm enjoying, you know, involving myself in the day-to-day grind of the podcast again. And so this was a super fun conversation with fan of the pod, member of the nation, Jade from Oso Oso.
And we don't even normally introduce the interviews, but I mean, that's just what it's Blink-155 classic.
I didn't do a proper intro, I think, when the interview starts. I'm just like, what's up, man? I had to add some context. Jade, thank you for joining us safe and sound from Philadelphia, where you are sheltering in place, you know, flattening the curve, doing your part, right?
Yeah. Doing the best I can to get the curve as flat as possible.
This is like a time when like sitting around and like playing video games, noodling on a guitar, doing like normal, like waste case shit is truly the it's most like heroic deed. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You're a troop now, essentially.
It feels great. I feel like I'm doing the things that I usually do just with my head perked up a little bit more.
Yeah, a little bit of a spring in your step.
Yeah.
Have you done anything like unusual, like where you're like, ooh, I'm in quarantine. I'm going to like, you know, learn to play the bassoon or something.
No, I wish.
Might I suggest learning the bassoon?
I can't even think of what a bassoon is if I picture it.
I feel like it's like a clarinet, but big. It's like a big kind of goofy clarinet.
Right.
But it's not a bass clarinet. Yeah, right. It's like a pipe. It's like a clarinet, but also a pipe, I think.
Something like that.
Did you ever play in like in band, like in concert band growing up? Like what was your actual like start in terms of like getting to play music in front of people? Because I know sometimes it's like someone puts a clarinet in your hand.
I did like a class in high school that was like where you had to learn trumpet, and I didn't do too well at it. But the first time I ever played in front of like audience was at a talent show at my middle school. We covered I'm Not Okay by My Chemical Romance. And that was the first thing I ever did in terms of playing music in front of people.
Have you ever played a Blink 182 song in front of people?
Yes. Damn It, obviously.
Sick. What was the context of your Damn It performance or performances?
It was this band I played in called Mooseport, and we were playing some kid's birthday party, and everybody was so upset that we were playing except for the kid whose birthday it was. And then someone was like, can you play Blink-182? And then we played Damn It.
Did the room like go off? Did it totally change the vibe? Like that's when the party shifted?
No. That one kid was like stoked, but that was it.
Such is the way anytime anyone yells at a cover, I think.
Yeah, it wasn't like a movie thing where like everyone kind of just went crazy after that.
It was just
like one kid was like, okay, cool, thanks.
Sometimes though, I do feel like the right cover in that situation can like fully like turn like a house show head. Do you guys play covers? Like, do you ever do that to like just like switch shit up? Make the house go crazy?
I feel like we used to play them way more. The last one that I could think of, I play, if it's ever like a solo set or whatever, I try and play a bunch of covers. But the last thing that I can remember us doing a cover of is that Big Star song that like Cheap Trick covered for that 70s show.
Yeah, that's a good one. People love that, man. Everyone loves that 70s show.
Yeah, it was fun to, like, we opened up, like, for a whole tour, we opened up our set like that. It was cool because it kind of got people to pay attention. At least they're like, oh, we know this song. And it was funny to just, like, start the set like that.
That we used to start our set by playing the theme from Jurassic Park. I feel like it's the same, like, just, like, you know, not playing it over the PA, but, like, physically playing it.
Yeah.
I feel like anything that you can do, especially depending on, like, obviously, like, what kind of show it is and whether or not people give a shit that you're personally playing it. It's like that way of grabbing someone's attention with something familiar and kind of dumb is a really sick way to start a set.
I think TV and movie theme songs too are like perfect for that.
So listen, we got to talk about the thing that really matters here. It's not that 70s show. I'm sorry to say it's not Donna. It's not even Big Star. We're here to talk about Blink 182. Now, more than Blink 182, we actually are here to talk about Blink 155. And you were telling me right before we started that you're like a fairly, you're a recent convert, but you have listen to the podcast. You have heard the podcast.
Yes.
Okay. So I do kind of desperately, for the sake of my own ego, need you to, I'm going to pretend that you're telling me for the first time. You know, I want to know how you got into the pod, man.
I want to know how you got into the pod, man.
It's how every interview starts.
How did you enter the cast?
Yeah, how did you come to enter this world, you know? So what was your gateway to cast?
So my Gay Week to Cast was my friend Anna was over my house a couple weeks ago, and we were talking about Joyce Manor and something that they did. Like, we just played a couple shows at Joyce Manor, and something that they did that was really funny was they had, like, there was this backdrop in San Diego where you could make, you could just, like, pull up anything you want on the computer and put it as the backdrop. And they put Blink-182 as their backdrop, and that just played the whole time that they played their set.
That's sick.
And then we were talking about that, and she was like, oh, have you heard his episode, Bear's episode on Blink-155? And I was like, I don't know what that is. And then she told me about this podcast, and then here we are.
Dude,
there's some segue. I totally saw you guys were like, we were on Twitter, and then I asked. I was like, hey, let me be on the cast. or the pod.
Which really, like, satisfied my ego, because, like, you know, it's always nice when people whose work you like the thing you like, especially kind of unprompted like that. So I should say, also an admirer of your work and a big fan of your band. So it was nice to know.
Thank you.
Nice to know that you were out there independent of me having you on the pod and complimenting you and enjoying the insanely useless thing that Josiah and I do. So real, I think, like, mutual appreciation here for two great masters of the form is kind of what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And so this is, like, the real, like, base level question. And I feel like Josiah is always constantly making fun of me subtly for asking this. But, like, mm-hmm. I always want to know, what was your gateway to Blink? How did you hear this band for the first time?
So my mom was, like, would just hear, like, a single and get obsessed with the single and then buy the whole album. I guess that, like, in the 90s, that kind of was how a lot of people like bought music and heard of bands, stuff like that. And she was really into All the Small Things, so she bought that whole CD, and then I don't think she ended up liking the CD besides, like, that and Adam's Song. And so then me and my brother just had it to listen to, and then
so it was like a hand-me-down, basically. Like, you got Enema of the State because your mom didn't like it,
right?
That's fucking awesome. Even, sorry, like, the way that you described it, like, I sense that I'm a couple of years older than you. And, like, even the, like, I guess people used to find out about music by hearing a single and then buying the whole record is, like, yeah, that was my entire life. And I don't even think I don't think I'm that old, but you described it like it was, like, out of time. Like, they used to hear the band on the American Bandstand and go out and buy the single at the mom and pop soda fountain where they also had a jukebox. Like, Jesus Christ.
All for a nickel.
Yeah, all for a nickel. And so you and your brother, like, inherited this CD because your mom just hated it.
I wouldn't say she hated it, but there was definitely stuff that, like, she liked, and that I don't think that was one of it. You know what I mean? Like, she never asked for it back or anything like that. But yeah, that was pretty much the gist, is, like, she would hear a single, like it, get an album. You know what I mean? And I think she was into All the Small Things. Since then, I, like, was pretty into Blink. I had a neighbor across the street, this kid Jonathan White, and he had the Mark Tom Travis show, and so that was, like, the first time that I heard. I wasn't familiar with, like, the curses or stuff like that. Because
were you not familiar with the fact that Blink cursed, or you weren't familiar with curses, like, period?
Oh no, that Blink cursed.
You'd never heard the word fuck before then.
Right, because I guess, I don't know if she got Enema of the State, like, censored on purpose, but that was censored. And then I bought Take Off Your Pants and Jacket and didn't know that it was the censored version.
Oh, so you've been just, like, living clean your whole life, eh?
Yeah, like, Happy Holidays? Is that, like...
Yeah, Happy Holidays, you bastard. Yeah.
Right, like, I had no idea that song was like that, because it was just it's just instrumental, and then at the end it's like, I'll never talk to you again, and that's what on the CD that I had like my whole life. That's what it was.
So what was it like for you when this whole new dimension of like cussing Blink-182 opened up? Were you shocked?
I was still young at this point. I was really young, so I thought it was awesome. I was like, okay, it's cool. I get now I get what they're talking about, because it was kind of just like, you know what I mean?
I got a friend who grew up like in a fairly, I guess, Christian household and only ever had the clean version. Like he grew up mostly listening to hip hop and only had clean like hip hop records. And as a result, still kind of prefers clean records. Like he's like, you know, it's just like the way that they do the back masking, like the different tricks that they use to cover up, because they're all kind of like percussive the way that they cover up. In hip hop, and he's like, I just kind of prefer clean versions. And I was like, that's the so bafflingly just like sweet. I want to just like bottle that up, but you preferred the cursing to the clean version because you're cool.
I thought it was fun. I thought it was cool. I mean, and plus, like, when I first heard them, I was pretty young. I mean, I don't know what our age difference is, but like when Enema of the State came out, that was what, like 99?
This is one of those things that I'm like supposed to know by heart by now, and I have to Google it every time. 99, yeah.
99, right, yeah. So I was 7, so like I didn't know, I just, even like certain parts I didn't understand what like anything meant, you know what I mean? Like an Adam song and like the apple juice thing, I'm just like, oh, they're singing about apple juice, you know what I mean?
Like, you're like, tight, I'm like, same, our interests are identical.
Yeah. Exactly, you know. So when I like found out about the cursing and stuff like that, I was like, oh, this is cool.
This is even cooler. Yeah. And so
yeah. And plus, the neighbor that I had that was like into them, this kid Jonathan, like I thought he was older, so I wanted to be cool. You know what I mean? So I was like, oh, this is cool.
Are you and Jonathan still tight? Like, do you ever see Jonathan?
No,
what's Jonathan up to?
No, I haven't seen that kid since I was like 9 or 10.
And so what was it like for you going back to albums like Dude Ranch? Because I know Josiah and I talk about this a lot. Like I'm 35, so I'm like whatever that is, old, seven, I don't know, I'm 7, 8 years older than you. And so Dude Ranch was like the record for me before like getting into the other stuff. And I still think that Dude Ranch is the best record, but I always wonder, like, if I was 10 years younger, if you're working backwards to Dude Ranch, like, is it too rough around the edges? You know, it doesn't have Travis. Like, what was your relationship to that record like? Because I know you're a fan.
Yeah. So for me, Dude Ranch, like, I was only familiar with Damn It, and then Josie was in, I think was in a video game or something like that. So I was familiar with that too. And then I didn't get into it until I was in high school. And that, like, I was kind of getting into, like, bands doing like Double Time and like punk like that, like No Effects and stuff like that at that age in high school when I was like revisiting older stuff like that. So I was into Dude Ranch because of that. You know what I mean?
It has the same energy. That totally makes sense. But did you ever go through a phase where you were like too cool for Blink? Like, did that happen to you?
I think that's probably, I'm in that now.
Oh, yeah. Even though you like are on a Blink-182 podcast, like this is your version of rejecting Blink-182?
Yeah, well, just after 9, I kind of just lost it. I just like, in terms of frustration, you know.
Oh, that's fucking fair, yeah.
Yeah, you know, but no, I mean, I feel like, because they kind of, here's the thing is that I once, so like Untitled came out and I wasn't really into, at that point I'm in like 6th grade. And I was looking forward to it, and I really liked feeling this. And so that album came out, and none of it really did anything for me at that age except for feeling this. And then that, like, I revisit that in high school, and I kind of view it like as like one of the greatest things I've ever heard. So that kind of always kept me like waving the Blink flag. And then they broke up, and then I was stoked when they got back together. That was like my senior year of high school. So I was excited to like go see them and stuff in that summer. And then I really liked Neighborhoods as well. So I just started to get into weed the same time I got into Angels and Airwaves.
Oh, that's a nice pairing.
Right. So when Neighborhoods came out, I was like, I was stoked on the songs that had that, like that kind of vibe, like the blood, not blood. I was almost said blood on the dance floor.
Oh yeah, Ghost on the dance floor. Yeah, Blood on the Dance Floor, though, a sick fucking band, though. We should talk more about them on this podcast. Is that stuff ever gonna like come back? Like,
Blood
on the Dance Floor. Blood on the Dance Floor. Was it Millionaires? You know, obviously Broken Side. The OGs, right? Respect. Did you like any of that? Was it all like? I mean, even like ironically?
No, that was like, yeah, that was like. Do you remember the site Absolute Punk?
Oh yeah. I mean, I was a punk news guy, but I'm familiar with Absolute Punk.
Okay, yeah, Absolute Punk was like my first glimpse of the internet in a weird way.
How troubling.
And that was like, I would just like kind of like, I didn't have a name or anything like that, a username, but I would just like lurk the message boards. And that band was not, Broken Side was not cool on that website. So I was officially, there's no way I was going to let that be cool to me or even listen to it or try to get into it.
You should watch it now, because like, as someone who was a little bit older when those bands blew up, I was like, I felt no need to shit on it. You know what I mean? It was just like one of those things where it was so transparent how like kind of over the top and transgressive it was.
Would you put 303 in that same?
Oh, yeah, I think so. Like, I also wrote for Alternative Press around that time, and they were covering the ever-loving shit out of all those bands. And in retrospect, I know someone who's friends with the guy from 303's wife. And is like he's such a nice dude. And he also like writes songs for Lonely Island. And so I'm like, maybe 303 aren't totally, because like Blood on the Dance Floor and Broken Side and like those bands were like out of their fucking minds.
Right.
And doing, whereas like 303 was just sort of like trashy and horrible. I don't know. Do you think of those bands as being kind of the same?
Here's the thing. I never listened to Broken Side, really. I remember when that was going on. 303, like, I'll be in the car with my girlfriend, and we'll be driving for, like, 3.5 hours, and we'll, like, run out of stuff to play. And then she'll play something, and I'll be like, what the fuck is this? And she'll be like, oh, this is 303. I used to love this. And I was like, what?
Was that, like, troubling for you the first time that happened?
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, not troubling that she used to like it, but troubling hearing it, the actual music. I was like, what the fuck is going on right now? Because it has that vibe, like you said, that I guess he writes songs with like Lonely Island. Like it has, you're kind of waiting for that punchline to come and it doesn't. And it's just like a pop song like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, totally. It's like an unself-aware like Lonely Island. Yeah, it's very difficult.
Yeah.
Dude, I cannot say enough good things about every Broken Side music video in existence. They're like, I once did an interview with like Damian Abraham from Fucked Up, who also loved Broken Side, where we like, he did the interview, like at the time I was like shooting videos. And so I got him to interview the band, because he very seriously was like, what they are doing is like punk as fuck. Like they've invented something new. And they were also like, I think they were from Albuquerque, and it wasn't
I was going to ask where they from, because I feel like they have to be from somewhere that's just like not, where it's not easy to fall into this thing that everyone's doing.
Exactly, you know? Yeah. And it was like, there was an element of like, I think there was like a class thing too. Like they weren't like well-to-do kids, like, you know, with good instruments. Like they were like, you know, coming from a particular place was sort of my impression. And so Damian like was obsessed with Broken Side too. And so we interviewed them and we weren't going to go to the show. And then we like had such a good time interviewing them. Like, do you want to go to the show? And so it was like me and Damian from Fucked Up, my wife, went to go see Broken Side. And it was like the sickest night. So I cannot recommend enough. If you have not experienced those videos, I feel like
do I YouTube like an official music video, or do I do like Broken Side live?
I would say I'd start with the official videos and then just let it ride, man. Just let it fucking ride. Do you still smoke weed?
Oh yeah, all the time. Listen, especially now.
You're gonna have a great night.
These times.
Yeah. You're gonna have, I'm so excited.
How I was like, do I look up the live video or do I see the official video? Like I'm thinking like, you know what I mean? I watch one or two videos, you're like, oh no, start here.
Yeah, just let it
and
let
then
it play,
work
man.
Your way here.
Yeah, I'll send you like a heat map of the best Broken Side content for sure. When it came to like other bands of this era, though, like the Bling, you know, like the MXPX's, Goldfinger, like Messed, I don't know, like the Fringe is like, how much did you just sort of fuck generally with sort of like, you know, this era of like baggy shorted pop punk? Like, was this sort of your thing, or was Blink like kind of a specific kind of outlet for you?
No, I think it was kind of, it was like, Blink was there. So I wasn't really into like, my like in terms of my interest at the age when I got into Blink, it was like I liked Blink 182, and then like as I got older, when I was like in middle school, I liked Good Charlotte as well, and then that was really it in terms of like rock. And then as I got into like eighth grade or high school, I started to get into like more like emo stuff like that, and kind of like then through high school, it was like emo punk, like kind of like just explored everything that was like kind of like had guitars in it. But yeah, in terms of like that stuff, I would say like it was like Blink 182 and Good Charlotte were about it.
Josiah is your compatriot on the Good Charlotte tip. I never got that into my band, into that band. My sister loved them, and I think one of the Maddens follows him on Twitter, and he's like always thinking about asking him on the pod, but he's like afraid to do it. Like if he does, he'll find
That'd be so great. I would love to.
Wouldn't it be sick?
I think those dudes write like really good songs. The two brothers, I guess they write together. Like they write really, really good hooky songs.
I think, but I tried to deny it because it was just like a little, I was trying to be too good for it at the time, you know?
Yeah.
But I was out somewhere in public and Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous came on, and I was like, oh my God, this song fucking goes. Like, it's really, right? Really good.
Yeah, it's like if you just kind of block out, like, because I feel like if you have to be a certain age to like relate to that hard and like get into it, be like, oh, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
But that song really does go hard as fuck.
It's fucking sick.
You know?
It's just like the chorus, man, and it's so ironic because now they're rich and famous, you know? It's like right. A little bit of a wink and nod.
Yeah.
Okay, so you also, I did want to ask though, because you mentioned like Blink getting back together when you were in high school and going to see them then. And so like, do you remember what that was like? So this band that you like had gotten into at a young, impressionable age breaks up, they get back together. You're still in high school when that happens, which kind of sounds sick. Like what was, do you remember that experience of like seeing them live for the first time in high school?
Yeah, it was awful. And then it's not, and that has, it really has nothing to, it's like nothing to even do with them. It's just the, at that point too, like I had only been to like, we were just talking, like when I was in middle school, I saw like Good Charlotte in like an arena, and that was pretty cool. That was like the first concert I ever saw.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was just like pretty much just all club shows. And so because I was in like, this was the summer that I graduated high school. That I saw them. So that was the first time I ever saw a show at like an amphitheater. And I was like, I spent like $60 on tickets, which as like an 18-year-old is like crazy. Like that's all your money. That's like a whole like week's worth of like summer job money. So I was like, oh fuck, you know? And it was just like a terrible experience. You could hear like people talking to you, like next to you over, the music, and it was like the first tour back, so everybody and anybody was there. There was like genuinely people who like had no interest of being there, just talking over you as you stood high up in like the rafters of this amphitheater.
I'm so sad for you. Vicariously, this is it. I'm distressed. Did you have like a redemptive experience with them live? Like, have you had a good, even though they have maybe that gotten worse, have you gotten better?
That was it. That was the only time I saw them. Yeah.
That's fucking heartbreaking.
But to be honest, I'm glad that I saw them when Tom DeLonge was still in the band.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, you know, you've got a precious memory there for sure. Do you like Alkaline Trio?
I love Alkaline Trio. I love Alkaline Trio, and I have absolutely nothing bad to say about Matt Skiba. I think Matt Skiba is like a great...
Thank you. Musician. Thank you for finally having someone on the pod who will defend Matt Skiba's honor. I appreciate that.
Yeah. You know what I mean? I have nothing bad to say about Matt Skiba. I think from what I heard of the new album 9, it sounds like they like mixed or like distorted his voice or something to try and make it sound like Tom's. And I was just like, this is a terrible, like, I feel like he's going to get shit on for this, but I feel like it's not, I doubt he walked into a studio and was like, hey, make my voice sound like this guy's.
I got an idea. I mean? This is how I'm going to sneak in.
Right. Like, I doubt that was on him. Yeah.
Well, it's hardly the worst thing about Nine. I will say that.
Right. Yeah.
Well, I appreciate you bringing some respect for Matt Skiba to the pod. I also appreciate that we were able to chat. We were star-crossed a little bit. My band was intended to play the same night as your band was in Toronto, but at a different show. I think maybe before yours got announced. And so we were super bummed because we were playing a show at the Bovine with some pals. You guys had a show at the Hard Luck. Neither of us ended up playing Toronto. Hopefully one day we'll be able to, you know, play shows again.
For sure. I hope your guys' show gets rescheduled as well, too. It doesn't look, unfortunately, I guess, because it doesn't look like we'll be able to get back over there in time by June. They're saying that it still looks like it would be hard to get over there. So
I think it's going to be.
Hopefully we'll be back soon.
It's going to be intense for a while. So listen, I know you're in quarantine like the rest of us. Normally this is a sort of a spot in a podcast where someone would be able to like promote something they were doing, which might just be smoking weed and watching Broken Side videos. But you know, especially because you had to cancel your tour. Is there any particular that people can do, to support, you know, you guys? Is it like Bandcamp? Is it merch? Like what's your poison? What's the best way for people who weren't able to see you live on this tour to kind of still hang and still support you?
I was just keep in touch with the Twitter and the Instagram and stuff like that. If we end up putting the merch from the tour online before we go back out on tour, then we'll like obviously post about that. Please like keep a lookout for the other bands on the tour as well, like Sincere Engineer, Max Seal, Just Friends, Prince Daddy. They all have merch up online, so like check out that too. But
hell yeah. Well, listen, enjoy sheltering in place. And, you know, thank you for listening to a podcast about the band Blink 182 and coming to be on it. It was sick to have you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, for real. Burning lights on the street of fire, fighting depravity.